I know.
I don't know how long it'll take, but I appreciate everybody being there to help. Before we get started, I'd like everybody to stand up. Also, I went over to visit Charlotte Payne again yesterday. She got quite a full nail. She's nowhere close to being out of wood. She's got a real bad cough, real weak cough, but at least she's got life support. On the road recovery, she's gonna have to have major heart surgery, but they said they'd like to give her strength to help her to do that. So, I'm gonna hurry.
Oh God, our righteous and kind heavenly Father, we thank you for another day of life, for the many blessings you give. Most of all, we thank you for sending Jesus into this world to have life and have it for a month. Lord, we come to you this morning, remembering Charlotte and many others that are sick and afflicted, needing your touch. We ask you, Lord, just to go before this day and choose the path you will have us to travel. As we gather today to do the county business, we ask you to bless each of our elected officials. Go with us through the remainder of this service. Open our hearts and direct our minds. Whatever we accomplish will never fail to bow our heads and hearts. Give you honor, praise, and glory for all things. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Hey, before we get started, I've got a few things that we need to handle.
Hey there, here's Steve.
Dean, will be consideration of approval of the vote form. Q, will be a resolution for grammar and type, and a resolution to shut the county service down.
Surrender.
R, will be consideration of approval to adopt concrete, blue roll, and level lane into the road. And the next one is consideration to pay embassy suite in the amount of $755.55 for training for the new district. And then T is discussing the lease agreement for the property where the monetary cool building is on county property. And then U is a presentation by DLD. Eric Grant will be doing that feasible study for it. And then V, Mayor Mark Warman wants to speak about the Cedar Jackson building at Camden.
Is that all the add-ons you got, Jim?
I can hear you.
Is that all the add-ons you got?
Yeah.
We'd like to add on to the agenda too also. Add January 21st special meeting for the approval of the minutes. Also, we need to add the K Beans Award.
What now?
K Beans Award.
KD?
Beans, B-E-M-S, B-E-E-M-S Award. That's a $20,000 award for the Bridge Wood Family Service. Also, we need to go to executive session, discuss personnel, tax issues, and.
Tax issues, you say?
Right. And also, we got some people in the audience that would like to speak, so we'd like to add that too.
Okay, what we do on that, I've always been One, I think that's real important. It depends on how long the meeting goes, but if somebody wants to speak, does anybody want to speak to Jim in the audience? Let me get a paper. You don't want Jamie? Okay. That being added, first order of business will be approve the minute of special meeting.
We have to take a motion to approve the.
Well, we've done it the last three or four times. Every time we get down and want to do something, I'll just go ahead and add to it. You say we can do it on record meeting, so I don't see no need to record.
Still have to.
We choose to do it.
Still have to.
I vote.
Okay, we'll make a motion and opt it in with no addition.
I mean, no addition.
We have a motion.
What do you say?
We discussed off everything we got down there. We're gonna adopt this agenda.
What we can be, Greg?
Do we have a motion?
We need to know what we're voting on. Are we gonna adopt?
Everything we got on the agenda here, yes.
Second.
Roy Darrell.
Aye.
Ray Moore.
Aye.
Al Changer. Sonny Wood.
Aye.
Okay. Okay, the approval of special meeting November 22nd through 2019. Regular meeting November 26th, 2019. Regular meeting December 17th, 2019. December 27th, 2019. Special meeting January 2nd. And emergency meeting January 24th.
14.
That being said, I don't know where y'all going to with it, but on these special meetings that you've called, I really don't think there's a gym that y'all got to vote and y'all choose to adopt over there. I'll consider a motion to do that.
You had the January 21st meeting also?
I thought that was bad on.
We can do it in this motion? Harry.
I got something I want to read before we do. No, let's go ahead and do twenty-first September. I got a lot of things I want to.
I've got that in.
Bring to you.
I've got the 21st in number W.
Yeah, we've already adopted it in, so it's going to be. Motion? A motion, okay. Finally, for consideration and approval for Lynn True to present annual report and update on solid waste management plan. Okay, we're good. I don't know if y'all gonna make it or not.
Yeah.
If I can go to you then, if you want to come up here to me, or if you want to stand back there, or what's best for you.
My name is Lynn True, Division of Waste Management, Environmental Protection, where I'm from. I brought Anita Young with me this morning. Anita is the local assistant for Breathitt County. She reviews your annual reports. So we are coming upon that season, March 1st. Every year, all counties are required to submit an annual report on the status and the progress of your solid waste programs. And that's all programs. That's from collection services to any facilities you have here in the county, recycling activities that go on. Basically, anything that has to do with solid waste management activities. So what we've been doing is, since there's so many newly elected officials here in the last year or two, we've been going around to all of our counties, explaining what our program is and explaining to you how it is we assist you with our program. Environmental protection, probably most people are familiar with inspections and going out and inspecting illegal dump sites or facilities and making sure that they're not polluting the environment. Our program, along those lines, helps counties out because there are certain things that counties have to do that they're required by statute to do. We specifically work with that program. It's called Local Assistance. So though we're state workers, we're here for you all. We're here to advocate for your county. And this program program's been around for more than 20 years. So with that said, what we do is every 5 years, you're required to submit a solid waste management plan and update it. Calvin Somm, I think, has been your coordinator for 15 or more years. I've done a really good job. He's very experienced in it. So your reporting seasons, your solid waste management plan is really very good compared to a lot of counties in the state. He's done a really good job with it. So we're not concerned with the quality of that at all. But we just want to make sure that all of our counties stay in compliance and the reports get submitted and that you're implementing the plan the way it's required to be. So so that's why we're here, just to talk a little bit about that. And I wanted to meet Nita too. She's fairly new to the program, and she's not been to a lot of her Eastern Kentucky counties. There's only four of us on the staff. My other employees here too, Shannon Powers, and then Deborah DeLong's back in the office today. But we're just making ourselves known. You may have met some of our coworkers. They run some of the grant programs. Lisa Evans, she does the illegal open dump grant, litter abatement, and she looks at those records and audits expenditures and that sort of thing. So just to give you an idea, and I'll give you my card and then Anita. Thanks, sir. Well, she has folders for all the magistrates and for you, Judge, so that you can read up on it, because it really is so comprehensive. It's always planning. That's why you need a full-time coordinator, because there is so much to it. It requires a good deal of knowledge, and a lot of time and effort goes towards what this job is all about. For one, in implementing your solid waste plan, you have to, as a county, provide collection services. And you are one of few counties that has mandatory collection. Mandatory meaning every resident here, everybody that owns property here, has to sign up for collection service and pay a fee. And the county is responsible for providing that service. Now, you can provide that service through a franchise. Some counties do it municipally owned, like Pike County, they have a municipally owned, they're a big county, and they have a whole department dedicated to it. They have their own trucks, their own fleet, their own labor, they do it all. But it's, as you can imagine, there's a lot entailed with that. There's a lot of money that you have to put up front to have a municipally owned system. So you all do a franchise. I think your franchise works for you pretty good. I know that also with your contract with your Waste Connections, I think.
Waste Connections, yes.
I know that according to your solid waste management plan, 15% of your franchise fees goes back into your solid waste program. So that helps your county out too. And a lot of counties don't have that set up. So I commend you all for doing that. That's a very, first of all, it's really hard to pull off mandatory collection, because a lot of people still burn garbage or throw it in the creek or throw it in the hollow. And don't really understand the importance of, it's not just unsightly, but there can be pollutions too that affect us, affect wildlife, affect the environment. So just as a safeguard for you, your community, that is why these programs are set up, and that's why we're here. So again, collection services, disposal facilities. Say you wanted to have a landfill approach you, and actually I got a call recently. I don't know if it will happen or not. Absolutely no reason to think that it's going forward, but it was very preliminary. Someone had called me about possibly locating a landfill here. And if that's the case, maybe you want a landfill here, but maybe you don't. You have, as the county, you have the statutory right and the responsibility to authorize or not if you want that landfill here. Maybe you want it here to help disposal costs. It's a shorter distance to drive to dispose of your waste. Maybe it will employ some people. But then on the other side, a lot of people don't want a landfill in their county. So, but you get to make the condition, you get to set up what you want in order for that landfill to site here or to locate here. So that's a big one. That is a huge benefit to counties that a lot of them don't realize they have that level of authority. And we work with some counties that have kind of gotten in trouble with landfills that have taken advantage of the community. I don't know, Boyd County, if y'all heard what went on with Big Run up there a few years ago, it was really awful. That finally got worked out. But yeah, we got it straightened out so that the county has a better facility and they make more revenue off of the facility too, because they understand that in a contract, you can negotiate terms, and that's where it gives you some leverage. So yeah, it's really about having the rights back to the people. like I said, we wear the state shirt, and we carry the state label, but please don't judge us for that, because we really are here to serve you all. This is for you all, this is for the benefit of the county. Anita's a great person, she has 20-plus years of experience with permits, so when it comes to facilities, she's gonna be a very good advocate for you. So, that's pretty much all I got to say on the five-year plan. Now, we're in the middle of that planning cycle. The next one, this one expires 2022, so we'll start preparing the next one in 2021. Calvert, I guess you've done, what, two of them now?
Three.
You've done three solid waste management plans, and let me tell you, they are a year in the making. There's a lot to it. You have to get a lot of signatures, you have to get approval, has a resolution from fiscal court, has to sign off on the plan. The activities and the goals that are set forth in the plan, those are discussed with the advisory committee and with fiscal court. You all are the governing body. Breathitt County is set up as, the solid waste management area is all of Breathitt County and then the incorporated city of Jackson. So, all of the, this is your jurisdictional area for solid waste. And that's how that works. I'm gonna let Anita talk now about annual reports, whereas the five-year plans come up every 5 years, and we're still in the middle of that. And we still need to implement those on a yearly basis. But Anita's gonna talk about what is due March 1st of every year, and we just simply call it an annual report.
Again, my name is Anita Young, thank you all for having us today. I'm briefly just gonna talk about annual reports. We have information for you in the folders that you can look at a later date. So, again, the annual reports are due March 1st. You need to send out Form 5033 to all haulers and get their information back in order to do the form. So, in order to compile the information on your annual report, okay, so that does take some time. I'm here to assist, so if you need any, get any questions, I'm here to help you, okay? Why is the annual report so important? Well, as Lynn said, you know, being an energy and environment cabinet, our first main priority is to keep waste from going into the landfill, okay? We're tracking the information, all right? So, that's what we do with the annual report. We turn around and we take that information and report it to federal EPA to get the numbers, okay? It is regulated, so it is necessary to complete. Here's the form, and again, I have all the information in the folders for you. I won't go over every detail. But again, I'm in here if you have any questions. The report is due March 1st. We do give extensions by case basis, all right? And it's, but you must have the extension approved through us before March 1st, okay? Otherwise, we're gonna consider it late, and then it goes into non-compliant status. If the report is not completed on time, then you can move it into non-compliant status, which could interfere with the county getting the funding, the grants, okay? So, that's why it's very important to get that information to us by March 1st, okay? Also, it can go into a notice of violation issued with penalties that could also be applied, all right? Like I said, extensions can be granted if necessary. Just contact me, I'll make sure you have my card before I leave, okay? Let's see, I think that's pretty much it. Lynn, did I cover everything?
I think you did, and that's really the main points we wanted to get across. Mainly, we're here, it's a good program, it's for the county, it's a benefit to, but there are statutory requirements to meet, and we make sure that compliance is met on a yearly basis, too. You wanna keep receiving your grant funding for litter abatement, illegal dump grants, we have grant funding for recycling activities, programs, household hazardous waste collection events, composting even, and I think there's a new program called rubberized asphalt, which can cover surfaces of the county roads. That's a pretty neat program, too.
And there's waste tire grants, too.
Oh, tire grants. Waste tires are, that's the biggest problem there is, waste tires.
What's the status on the reports?
What's that?
You mentioned, Calvert, the status on the reports?
I've got no information to do any reports with at the moment, Donnie, I mean, so.
So they're due by March?
Yes, March 1st. So thank you, I appreciate you having us here, I know you've got a busy agenda. We have a lot to ask you.
Thank you all again. Next thing is consideration approval of December 29th, Dean Justice Center Corporation Fund Report. Do you have a motion?
Motion.
Okay, anybody here on second it? Ray Moore.
Aye.
Ellis Tensher.
Aye.
Donnie Bush.
Aye.
Roy Darrell.
Aye.
Next thing is consideration approval finding statement and appropriation review condition report.
Motion.
Second.
That you, Bill?
Yeah.
Okay. Ellis Tensher.
Aye.
Donnie Bush.
Aye.
Roy Darrell.
Aye.
Ray Moore.
Aye.
Motion carries. D, consideration approval of budget transfer.
There's two EBAs, man, for utilities.
They got that in the back of the?
No, it just, no, I didn't, there were just two, it was just.
You want out?
There are two, no, I didn't do an additional. In the jail, it's just your telephones and pagers, $150 from reserves for transfer.
You want out pagers?
Telephone slash pager, that's just the name of it.
Oh, okay.
$250 from reserve for transfer. And then LGA fund, airport utilities, $1,000 from reserve for transfer.
Can I need a copy of that, too? Okay, you have a motion?
Motion. Second.
Donnie Bush.
Aye.
Roy Darrell.
No.
Ray Moore.
Aye.
Ellis Tensher.
Aye.
Consideration approval of interfund transfer.
Motion.
Second.
Roy Darrell.
Aye.
Ray Moore.
Aye.
Ellis Tensher.
Aye.
Donnie Bush.
Aye.
Motion carries. And a consideration of fund activity reports.
Motion. Second.
Ray Moore.
Aye.
Ellis Tensher.
Aye.
Donnie Bush.
Aye.
Roy Darrell.
Aye.
Okay, consideration of approval of all legal bills on vendor claim list.
Has Flex fuel bill been paid on time this month?
No, sir.
Hey.
It's not.
I'm running this meeting, when you need to address something other, I'm not gonna sit here for 4 hours and have everybody comment. When you got a question, you ask me and we address it.
I asked you a question.
Okay, I thought you asked Chris, I'm sorry. Northwest Bank bill ain't been paid.
On time, I see.
I tried for over a week to get a copy, and I still haven't talked to anybody about the claim. You two, we could call and they would email it to us. For some reason, it got emailed, but it didn't come to my office, and I'm checking on that, but.
So we're not paying extra penalties?
We didn't get it, and we had a, here's why we didn't, here's why it ain't paid. We had a meeting that was called for Tuesday at 3:00. Got my secretary to come in on her day off, make the agenda, send it out, nobody showed up.
Was Flex bill on the agenda?
Wednesday, we got a copy of the bill. Crystal said, can we have a special meeting to have it? Are you kidding me? Y'all didn't come Tuesday, I didn't agree to come Thursday, Friday.
So you refused to have a meeting to pay the bill, is what you're saying?
I wasn't asking, but again, y'all wanna sit here and talk about pennies and nickels compared to $284,935. That Brendan Miller called me on Monday around 12:30 and asked me, could we have a meeting? And we got it together and had a meeting, but for some reason, y'all decided to have one at 10:00.
Means it.
that I was never contacted with.
That you refused, that the sheriff's department to have three different times, I think.
And again, I'm glad you named sheriff's department. Sheriff's department don't need to come to my house at 9:30 in the night on Saturday.
So you knew that.
You listen to me.
Okay.
I don't need the sheriff's department coming to my house at 9:30 in the middle of the night, be gone, no alarm going off, to ask a request for a meeting. Y'all know the admin code better than that.
We done it according to.
Admin code, no, you didn't do it. You listen to me, Donnie. Admin code states plainly, a transmitted copy. That could be a text, that could be a message, or that could be an email. Y'all didn't do either one. Because when Bridget came in to do it, I don't know if y'all realize it or not, my number, my email was not on this fax that y'all sent. It failed to go through. Y'all didn't check the fax machine to see if it went through. Y'all took it on yourself to call your own meeting.
Because we.
I was told, you listen, Donnie, I was told that we had to have that meeting the 21st to have a first reading or it wouldn't be any good.
Exactly.
$285,000.
Exactly, that's why we called a meeting, because you failed to.
No, because y'all chose to. Ms. Smith gave me an email, I got it at 12:42, I think it was, to ask if we have a meeting. Y'all had already contacted the paper company and stuff to have a meeting at 10 o'clock. Why didn't you tell us you'd already have a meeting? That's because we had it at 10. And again, it's not his job to do it.
All he had to do is show up.
He's a treasurer.
You and Mr. Harold showed up.
Hey.
And our county attorney.
Hey.
He knew it.
Don't send a law after my house at 9:30 in the middle of the night, be gone, and was told plainly that I was out of town for the weekend.
Who was told that?
Showed back up at my house Sunday at 4:30, and my daughter there. I appreciate that. I think that's harassing, to tell you the truth.
Are you looking at my house here?
I didn't say you did. You asked me a question.
I'm ready, but.
What'd you say? Okay. But I don't want the sheriff's department coming to my house and asking me to request a meeting. That ain't the way it's done. It ain't never been done that way. And I don't expect it to happen again. You all know how to call a meeting. Y'all got my phone number. Y'all didn't call my phone. You all didn't text me.
You failed them.
Why did y'all have Brendan? Why did you call Brendan asking when we have a meeting? And you already called one. And that's not your job to do that.
I didn't call and ask. Brendan called me, right? Because you.
I think we were talking about a different issue, and you said we have to have this.
That's right. That's right.
You ain't talking about the 21st, that we had to have a first reading.
I'm talking about Martin Luther King Day.
Yeah.
I don't remember exactly why we were talking, but it was on a separate issue.
That's right.
You said we have to have this passed by tomorrow.
Because I could keep it 3 weeks before.
Did he not ask if we have it?
I said I would call the judge right then. I called him. Both of you were on the phone in my office. And from there, everything's perfect.
And you know you have to have a 24-hour notice before you have a meeting. And then come to find out, you all called Roy Darrell Friday afternoon. Told him you're going to have a meeting. Why didn't you call me Friday?
You were able to call.
That's a lie. Well, that's a lie. I don't answer my call. I don't. You know, I didn't call me. Did you call me Donnie?
You was called.
Did you call me Donnie?
You was called.
Did you call me Ray?
This
did you call me
ridiculous.
Ellis? Did you call me Roy Darrell? Again, you all didn't call me and ask me about a meeting.
Bottom line is, I got a signed report that he received. It's on January 21st, Mr. Robert.
And you know what it's good for?
State local finance officer. If you want to jeopardize
$85,000. Hey, Donnie, you're listening. You ain't talking. I did call Robert Brown. I said, Robert, y'all know the package that you put in there? Right there, the copy of the budget amendment. Down at the bottom, it says county judge executive. You all have to love one another. And put county judge executive for acting chairman. You know what Robert Brown told me? The judge had to sign that. And you're not a judge, Donnie.
They got you in black and white.
You're not a judge.
You called Mr. Brown, called him.
I already did. It's no good.
What did he say? If he told me it was, that's exactly why I opted for
it. Why did you call him?
Because I'm the treasurer, the budget amendments are my property.
Why did you call me?
I didn't. I asked you three times to call me for that budget amendment 3 weeks before.
If you weren't jeopardizing,
you would. You know what? I got the pad. You said we need to be put on the agenda, and I got it in. I got the paperwork.
If you weren't jeopardizing the county,
you did today.
Almost $300,000 because you wasn't this, you wasn't that. You go ahead and do it, Mr. Smith.
Hey, a Again, you're listening, where was you at 3 o'clock on the meeting that was called that you was?
Because we don't address this, this is already sent to Franklin.
Hey, where were you at 3 o'clock?
Why didn't you have the flex bill on her, we showed up.
Where were you at 3 o'clock?
Where were you at?
I was right here.
Were you at?
Me and Brenda Miller.
When Mr. Miller notified you, why didn't you say, okay, I'll be at 10 o'clock, what?
He didn't tell me 10 o'clock, Mitch didn't tell me 10 o'clock. Mitch said, can we have a meeting, right, county attorney?
Totally did.
And I said.
I tried to get you two guys to get, okay? You spoke on the speakerphone, I had you on my cell phone, and my recommendation was to call the meeting, give 24-hour notice, and that's where we left.
Right.
At 3 o'clock.
I didn't get to see, but I noticed till 3 o'clock meeting, till about, what, 6 o'clock at the afternoon?
Well, listen, guys, this is all just a product of you guys not being able to communicate. And, you know, serving, I got no good answers for you. I'm just trying, there's no good answer.
So let's go on, the wet bill, the wet bank bill, we did not call a special meeting to have it. Evidently y'all like these special meetings, emergency meetings, and 4-hour-long meetings, but I don't care, I don't like them.
Well, you do your job.
And I think you're paying money.
Do your job.
Don't tell me to do my job. I'm here every day. Again, y'all wanna laugh or comment, I have to be removed, I'm being here to take care of county business.
No, you're not. You are not. Nothing's getting done.
I want Miss Tom.
You don't have to know.
That was me, that wasn't her.
You're still over here.
You're not putting me out of this court.
That's a citizen I won't get arrested.
Okay, I don't want anybody in here to comment on anything.
Of course you don't.
And sneering and outburst is a disruption. In my opinion, I don't want to hear from anybody.
Well, I'm a taxpayer, and you work for me.
That's right.
Yes.
Yes.
If you all wanna speak, you all raise your hand.
So I suggest you address it.
Yeah, that's it. Anybody else, I mean, you're taking your business, but I consider an motion on paying all legal bills on the claim list.
I make a motion.
You have a second?
Second.
Bill Tinker.
Aye.
Donnie Bush.
Aye.
Roy Opey.
Aye.
Ray Moore.
Aye.
Hey, consideration approval of second reading and adoption of budget amendment number seven.
Just so we're clarified, have you excused your request to have people removed?
Yes, I have. But if it does, if it happens again, they will be asked to move if it outbreak or sneering or talking down there. Consideration approval of second reading and adoption of budget amendment number seven, you got that coming?
Ordinance related to fiscal year 1920 annual budget and legal thereof, whereas the Breath County Fiscal Court has realized unbudgeted receipts from the following fund, be it ordained by the Breath County Fiscal Court of the Commonwealth of Kentucky.
Have a motion.
Motion.
Second.
Donnie Bush.
Aye.
Roy Darrell.
Aye.
Ray Moore.
Aye.
Bill Tinker.
Aye.
Consideration approval of the first reading of budget amendment 2020-BA-001.
Should read second reading.
You got that?
Should be second reading, Judge.
It's the first reading of budget amendment BA-2020-01, go ahead.
Okay, then call Freeport, call Freeport and tell them that you can't pay the jail bill because you jeopardized $250,000.
Donnie, we're here to take care of it, go ahead, Chris.
I'm trying my best, Judge.
Ordinance related to fiscal year 1920 annual budget and amendment thereof, whereas the Breath County Fiscal Court has realized unbudgeted receipts from following funds be ordained by Breath County Fiscal Court of the Commonwealth of Kentucky.
Okay, have a motion on that.
It's already been addressed.
And again, the reason so being.
It's already been addressed.
Y'all say call Robert Brown if you want to, I call Robert Brown, that next day, no, that day, 21st, Tuesday. And he said he had to have the judge's signature on it. You all have honored this form, and put county judge executive or acting chair.
That's a compliment.
So, do we have a motion on first reading? We have a second. No second to that motion.
It's already been addressed to us.
Donnie Bush.
No.
Roy Darrell.
Aye.
Ray Moore.
No.
Ellis Tensher.
No.
Okay, consideration approval to allow advertising for FEMA, number 4358.
You're not gonna do the next budget, Judge? Why don't you just amend to say, we're gonna be done with it. What's the big deal? So we'll get the money. Just amend the motion, second reading.
I did skip one, didn't I?
Yes, you did.
Consideration and approval of first reading of budget amendment 2020-BA-002. Sorry about that, you got it?
Ordinance relating to fiscal year 1920, annual budget, and amendment thereof, whereas fiscal court has realized on budget receipts from following funds, be ordained by the Michigan Fiscal Court and Colorado Kentucky.
Motion.
Motion.
Second.
Second.
Roy Darrell.
Aye.
Ray Moore.
Aye.
Ellis Tensher.
Aye.
Donnie Bush.
Aye.
Motion carried. Consideration approval to allow advertising for FEMA project number 4358, PW number 145, for test drilling.
Motion. Second.
Made that motion, you ready?
Yes.
Ray Moore.
Aye.
Ellis Tensher.
Aye.
Donnie Bush.
Aye.
Roy Darrell.
Aye.
Okay, consideration approval to open and award in steel rail piling bids, FEMA number 4239, PW number 4786.
Motion. Second.
And I don't know how to pop that bid.
He said you assigned that, so you'd be late.
This one here is from Mudcat Construction. Max Bridge Road, $10,800. Mill Creek Road is $24,480. Mill Range at Epitoy is $9,900. Moore Fork is $19,890. Pipe Mud Road is $42,000. Snake Branch Road, site number one, is $31,680. Snake Branch Road number two, $21,120. Stamford Fork Road is $27,840. Stray Branch Road, $24,480. Cedar Bend Road is $30,780. Hoover Drive, $87,150. Here you go, Donnie, I forgot about that. Okay, okay. Okay, this is King Creek Drilling. Nag Branch, road is $11,475. Mill Creek Road is $26,265. Miller Branch Road is $10,062. Moore Fork Road, no bid. Hot Mud Road, no bid. Lake Branch Road, site number one, is $33,660. Snake Branch Road, site number two, is $22,440. Stanford Fork Road, $29,580. Trey Branch Road, is $26,010. Cedar Bend Road is $32,805. Hoover Drive is $94,371. And on Cedar Bend, did I say $32,805? According to the bid sheet, Nack Branch, Donnie Bush is underbidded, his is $10,800. King Creek is $11,475. Mill Creek Road, Mudcat is $24,480. Versus $26,265. Miller Branch of Delcatoy, Mudcat is $9,900 versus $10,062 at King Creek. The next two, $19,890, Donnie's the only one, Mudcat's the only one bidding on it. Pipe Mud Road, Donnie is the only one bidding on it at $42,000. Snake Branch Road, Mudcat was $31,680. King Creek is $33,660. Snake Branch 2, Mudcat is $21,120 versus $22,440. Stanford Fork, Mudcat is $27,840 versus $29,580. Stray Branch, Mudcat is $24,480 versus $26,010. Cedar Bend Road, $30,780 for Mudcat, $32,805 for Cedar Bend. Hoover, $87,150. Mudcat and King Creek is $94,371. All these projects are, Mudcat has put the best bid in on all these projects, and I would consider a motion to award the bid to Mudcat Construction for these sites. Did you say that right?
Yeah, it's deep.
Okay. Donnie Bush.
Aye.
Roy Darrell.
Aye.
Ray Moore.
Aye.
Gil Tanner.
Aye.
Okay. Mudcat, you've got to bid on both projects.
Thank you.
I appreciate the good work you do. I went out and checked every site first and did some done, and couldn't be more pleased. I appreciate it.
I appreciate you all. Thank you very much.
Consideration and approval of quarter report of second quarter of fiscal year 2020. Fiscal year.
Motion.
Second. Roy Darrell.
Aye.
Ray Moore.
Aye.
Gil Tanner.
Aye.
Consideration approval to amend the administrator code, page 44 and page 79. Y'all got a copy of that? Have you had time to look at it? And you care to read the amendment? You probably need a copy of this table for your exemption out, don't you? It's just paragraph. Did you go ahead and get the changes and I'll get it? approved amendment to the code. On page 44, what it states, it says each employee is notified hereby, the sheriff should notify the county judge executive within 5 calendar days of any criminal drug offense, and meet you for a violation in the workplace within 30 days to take place. It's got here, it just says any employee violating this criminal policy of the drug shall be immediately dismissal. What I want to change you to, it's on page 40, it's on paragraph 4, so you can get your admin code, look out and look if you haven't done it. And it really didn't come out, we were playing, we were making changes. But it says any employees to be abusing drugs but not convicted of a drug status violation will be subject to appropriate personnel action up to and including termination, or be subject to appropriate personnel action up including termination, or be required to participate in a satisfaction in a drug abuse assistance and rehabilitation program approved for such purpose. And also, if it does do that and choose to allow an employee to do that, the employer will be, the Redding County Fiscal Court is not required to pay for your rehabilitation. And it says any employee violating these terms and this subject to immediate dismissal. And what I want to add to that also, it says employees found through any reasonable testing procedure determined by executive authority to be abusing drugs, whether or not convicted of any statute violation, will be immediately suspended without pay for a minimum of 4 weeks during which time employee will be required to participate in satisfaction drug abuse assistance and rehabilitation program approved by the executive authority for such purposes. The employee is not required to pay for this rehabilitation. Any employee to have violated this term or policy being found to abuse drugs or any controlled substance shall be subject to immediate termination without consent of the fiscal court and at the hand of the executive authority. As means of assuring compliance with this policy and preserving this county eligibility for federal and state assistance, all employee contractors of Redding County Fiscal Court, as a condition of their contract employment agreement, shall be subject to substance abuse testing as prescribed by the executive authority. And I think right now making these changes is really, really important. We had a judge that and without taking a road with one employee and came in with the sheriff's department there waiting on him and got rid of half of his they ended up having selling myth right out of the county garage and it don't look good on him, and he was embarrassed and thing. But I'm worried about the safety more than anything. We had a drug test the 1st of July. It was claimed to be illegal because and this is the next amendment. I'm gonna go ahead and go get right now before
you go on
discussion.
Did I say something?
Yeah.
Part where you said any employee found to have violated the term of this policy by being found to have abused drugs or other controlled substance shall be subject to immediate termination without the consent of the fiscal court at the hand of the executive authority. Was that you? Was that clearly violates KRS 67710 paragraph 7, which states that you may exercise with the approval of the authority to appoint, to supervise, and suspend, and remove any personnel.
What page are you on, 79?
I'm on KRS 67710. And cannot remove anybody or suspend without the fiscal court's approval. This year does not line up with the KRS.
But we're going to be a zero tolerance county.
You got to go under by law with you. That's a whole problem. That was the first drug case you did.
What's the problem?
You violated HIPAA violations.
We're going to be a zero tolerance thing. The judge who made the call the other day, he removed him immediately. I ain't saying that he didn't conduct the physical court, but this also, and let's go ahead and read this other paper because it actually includes us in it also.
Would you consult on this, Mr. County Attorney, on this?
Okay.
The judge's executive did not consult you on this legality there.
Here you go. So see, go on through here, and then we'll talk about what change you're going to make. On 79, here's where you all were claiming the drug test was illegal. When this admin code was broke up in, I don't know what year, but the county owned the health department. And here's where y'all were leveraging with that. You said the county shall contract with the Department of Health, Human Resource Certified Laboratory. Samples to be tested shall be obtained at the Breathitt County Health Department. The county will designate a medical review officer to review possible results. There were y'all saying it was illegal, but at the time, I don't think you all even realized that the Breathitt County Health Department, we don't own it anymore, and that they don't even do drug testing, period. They actually recommended us to go to primary care, to cut the place that I use. So, I think once we eliminate that, and what I want to do here is that the county shall contract with an appropriate licensed professional and authority to determine by executive authority to perform any and all substance abuse testing by county. Samples to be tested may be obtained at the discretion of executive authority. The results of such tests will be reviewed by the executive authority and a medical review officer as designated by executive authority. And what the language I want to add is got changed the language. So change the language to, for the purpose of this policy, the county has determined that the physician impact of the safety and welfare of the community are therefore subject to mandatory random testing. And that includes employees required to have a CDL, commercial driver license, emergency medical service director, assistant director, captain, lieutenant, emergency medical technician, medical technician, paramedic, and detention center employees. And I want to change that from that part, that's what's in there now, change it from that part to, for the purpose of this policy, the county has determined that all physicians from county personnel, and that includes us, all those involved in government service related to the physical court, serving the physical court in any fashion impact the overall well-being and STEM to the community, and are therefore subject to mandatory testing as prescribed by executive authority as mean by his administration function. And I think, you know, changing the language there, what we took out of medical employees, we don't have those employees in the registers and lieutenants and those people. I think it just shows people that we are going to be zero tolerance on our drugs.
Nobody disagrees with that. The thing is, whatever policy that we come up with, it's got to be legal and you cannot violate people's rights. That's the whole issue. We were supposed to got together with the county attorney and come up with a policy that everybody was on the same page, that did not break the law or violate anybody's rights. That's the whole issue.
Okay. What I'm going to do is consideration of motion to approve the changes with the discretion of the county attorney going over it, making sure it is tailored if violation. I really think it is. I think it's all within the means. Y'all had the copy of these back in June in the packet. I don't know if y'all took time to look at it or not, but they were in there back then. So I want to consider a motion to go ahead and make these changes upon county attorney to prove that it is in statute of KRS.
Is it legal for you to change state laws yourself? Sounds like that's what you're trying to do.
What the motion was made is to, and again, y'all, just raise your hand and I acknowledge you, but this is a recommendation. If the county attorney said it's in compliance with KRS, if it ain't, we'll look at it and make changes and come back next time.
Well, why don't we get together with the county attorney and make a policy and adopt it? Of Canterbury. What's, it don't make sense.
Yeah, can I make a suggestion? Why don't you call a meeting and have a work session and discuss it all? Because it's noticed, the public can come. If you want to do it now, I mean, for that, why don't you have a special meeting or something to discuss the whole thing and pass it there the first reading? Of course, now what you're doing here is trying to amend the administrative code. Now, that's only doable in June by certain things, but it is an ordinance, so you guys can amend that during the year if the judge brings these changes and you got to vote on it. But you have to vote twice.
And it's what I like for my motion to be is to amend these changes, as long as the county attorney said it's in compliance with KRS, then if you don't, then we'll back up and go to Plan B. If it is compliant, I'd like to go ahead and this would just be the first, we'd have to do another reading on it. So, do we have a motion?
Judge?
Yeah.
Are you saying that you want to replace the whole entire policy? Wait a minute. The whole entire policy with all the explanation of what random testing is, what suspicious testing is, et cetera, and how it's done with just those simple statements?
No, you would still have to go through that, to stay within my... I say this is in compliance with KRS, because I didn't just write this up and say that'll work. I had two different people look at it. We're just amending on page 44, paragraph number 4, maybe I didn't make that clear. And then on 79, we're just changing the one section in there where it says the county health department has to contain the feces and all that.
No, you're reading the whole thing.
We're not changing the other reading as sufficient and all that for all that. That's all still stay the same. Only two things we're changing is two paragraphs and...
You're just wanting to say that whenever someone walks in the door, you can decide to test them, correct?
No.
Random testing.
Random could be that.
Means for anybody and everybody.
Anytime I suspect anybody, I mean, that...
Oh, that's one thing.
Yeah.
But are you saying that with this description, random testing is anybody and everybody? It covers anybody and everybody?
Yeah.
Not just as the policy says, your drivers?
Right.
Your drivers?
And I've got to add, because if you want to look at it, and I thought you took it, but all that thing is the same, suspicious and all this stuff, but...
No, it doesn't, because random testing is part of that. It changes more than that, Judge. A work session would be a great idea to change it the proper way, so that everything is changed that needs to be. I mean, I think everybody agrees we need a good drug testing policy, right? You know?
I'm just going to be zero tolerance on drugs, and I think the only change, and we're not changing all that, we're going to change two paragraphs, no error made motion. Have a second. I'm going to second that motion again. This is not changing it today. This is to do these changes. If they're according to KRS, and Brandon says it's okay, then we'll come back and do a first reading and a second reading. So if you are against drug test, I mean against the drugs and one zero tolerance, I'm going to second that motion. Ray Moore?
No.
Ellis Tensher?
No.
Donnie Bush?
No.
Roy Darrell?
Aye.
I'm going to move the house, so motion failed. Again, long as I'm going to be judged, we're going to be zero tolerance on drugs. Consideration and approval of Brazos County Clerk, 2020 account budget. Any questions? Have y'all looked over it and went through it? Recommend any changes?
Yeah, we met with Becky and Ashley the other day, discussed her budget. And last year we gave her $205,000 for her deputies. As we figured out if there were all fees or increases, vacation, based on 37.5 hours a week, with overtime, hour a week, life insurance, health insurance, bike and match, unemployment insurance, her total cost is $204,826. The remaining amount of that is $205,000. Line items, we changed two line items. Line item number 41, she had budgeted zero. Minimum amount is $4,400 for training, fringe benefit. That's an add-on. Prevention from travel, she had budgeted $9,500. Minimum amount is zero. $205,000 on our deputies, everything included.
which is a $21,450 decrease.
So you're cutting from 205 on the maximum security, maximum to what?
221 to 225. Her proposed budget was $221,000 on her annual order.
Okay.
We're gonna give her, what we gave her last year was $205,000. I just read what her cost was. Been over $204,000.
Can I speak?
Okay, so you're saying you're just approving of the budget last year maximum, right?
On her deputies, correct, with everything included.
Where'd you come up with 221 at, what'd you?
That's what Becky proposed, the last time we talked to her. I think it's in her budget. Correct, Becky?
Yeah, I've got a copy of it, so.
That's what you all told me I was gonna agree with. Right, Donnie?
No.
Yes, you did.
No, we did not.
Yes, you did. Okay. I wanna talk to y'all. I am the clerk of this county, and I have tried my best to get on with this board. They refused to meet with me.
We met with you, Becky.
And I, because I chased you down out here to holler on me.
Well, you did.
Okay, we did. And you all had told me if I would go to jail, and I would bargain with jail, you all would agree on my budget.
You what now?
Yes, they did. Actually, am I not telling the truth?
Who did?
And I didn't have the heart to do that, Jeff. Because I'm being the clerk, and I'm doing the best job I know how to do. My records, I didn't wanna do that, because I didn't think that was the right thing to do. My record stands for itself. Anybody can come in there and look at how I run that office. I run the office the best way I know how to do. And you all said, you go bargain with jail, and we'll pass your budget what you asked for.
Really?
I didn't go to jail because it wasn't the right thing to do.
You all told your lips.
Jeff, I didn't have the heart to come and tell you that, but I really did think about it. Because I wanted my, and don't you, I'm talking. Okay, this magistrate right here is in my district. He licensed his vehicles at another county. Okay? He really cares for this county, don't he? Well, I take my own gas, and I drive to Perry County to pick up all the break the county transfers. That's how I care about my county. I take not a dime's worth of gas to do that. And they wanna fight my budget. I paid every bill over there for my workers, every one of the insurance payments. I have not come before this fiscal court and asked for one dime. I have ran that office for myself. I have laid awake and tried to think about things I could do to better that office and to be a good county clerk. That's what I've done. And look where it's got me. I sat right in here the other day and chased these magistrates down and told them I love them. And can we please work with each other? And I thought my budget was getting passed today, Donnie.
You're really,
don't you
you're really showing it.
Hey, hold on.
The love, I can feel it.
Yes, I know that, Donnie Bush. Because you told me you was going to pass it.
Hold on.
You want to go to jail and ask for y'all's expenses to be paid. That's what you told me.
Okay.
Hold on. Beck, go ahead and.
I can get to jail if I get angry. When I try to do the best job I know how to do, and they're going to fight me over my dang budget.
If you want to get personal, man, let's get personal.
Yeah, let's get personal.
No, we ain't getting personal. It's already got personal.
Beck, you sued the county for over $250,000.
Hey.
You wouldn't pay your bills. They had to garnish your check.
Hey, where's your debt? Hold on.
I never sued the county for that. How come you wouldn't pay Jackson Hosa and they had to garnish your check? And you can't manage the county's money.
You don't know anything about it.
Let's go.
Let us both out.
Becky and Donnie both.
Come on, Donnie.
Let's put up with this.
What's the legalities on removing?
At this point, I think everybody just needs to calm down. I think the legality is that it has to go to a vote of the body to remove a member.
I tell you what, it's pretty hard to calm down.
Let me say one thing.
Wait. Before anything happens, what do you want done? You want her gone?
Go ahead and take that down. I'm sorry, Becky.
What about?
Yeah, what's
the situation there?
Let me talk to Brandon here. Make sure. Go ahead and something.
My understanding is for a member of the assembly, being one of you five, to be removed, it has to be a majority vote of the assembly to do.
It has to be 66% of the vote. Am I not right?
Majority.
It's according to Robert Gordon's rule, it is.
Better read again.
Go ahead. She said Donnie asked her. Bribe me or call me in or working with him. Go ahead and make Donnie out. I'll bring back the legal part of that. I ain't gonna was all me asking. I picked her a big example of that, to try to get order.
So you're throwing out.
I'm gonna make a motion, see if I'm throwing down the, I'm gonna make a motion to adjourn.
Yes, yes. You're treating this place.
Everybody's gonna do is establish what's legal. You're the county attorney. The judge has requested he be removed.
I stated my opinion.
Who's the vote? Who votes?
That the fiscal court votes, it's gonna be 30, if it's gonna be 3-2, it's gonna be a 66% anyway. That's 60%, I'm sorry.
Take your vote.
60%.
Take, I make a motion to take a vote, remove Donnie from the court reading. No second. Donnie Bush?
No.
Roy Darrell?
Aye.
Ray Moore?
No.
Ray, Al Changer? Ain't got 66% of vote, that's 60% of vote, I'm asking to be removed.
I'm asking if you're gonna.
Go ahead with one thing at a time, one thing at a time.
Well, you're not, I'm asking if Donnie Bush is removed, so go ahead and let's vote, adjourn this meeting.
Go ahead and get him out, and we'll vote to the next part.
Let's clarify, Judge, what was the purpose of the vote if you're not gonna follow the legal procedures for the vote?
Ask county attorney, what's the legal procedure?
I told you what I know.
He just did, he just.
What else can be?
66%. Three and five is 60. I mean, that's all we got. They voted three and two, no, that's 60%. 60, 40. That's right. 66%.
Who's got the rules, man?
Pardon?
Who's had the rule, man?
And then read your one, then call me and ask him.
I ain't telling you. I want you to.
Give me a last time.
Everybody just keep calm, we'll figure it out.
Where's Robert's rules of order?
Real simple stuff, man.
My dress.
Again, this meeting in session. The last time we had this same conversation, we went up and came in and said.
I hadn't called anybody, but nobody knows the answer, but it was replaced.
And I read it on proper order, rule of order, so keep on playing.
Ron, you won't be in here, Jim.
right beside him, Major's out there at his station. When it's in the area ruled by a vote, the side takes certain persons shall not remain in the room. If the duties of a chairman to enforce the rules of order, using whatever force is necessary to eject the party, the chairman can detail members to be removed from that person without calling upon the police. If however, if enforced the order, anyone using harsh measurement necessary to remove a person, the court has to be held. He and he alone is liable for damages, just the same as the policeman. And it would be similar circumstances. Here, badly demands to be abused or removed from the room.
Bob, you good?
What article is that? What article is that, sir?
Let me go back to.
This book is not, I don't believe it's written.
That is Article 13, legal right to assembly of punishes members, Article number 72. Article number 73, right to assembly to eject anyone from his place of meeting.
Let's go for the vote.
And then it goes to trial for members of society, and I think that's.
Well, there's no question, it goes for the vote.
That's where it goes for the vote, and then.
How many of the cuts?
We are assembly, Joe.
Yes, we all are.
Oh, you chair.
Our five of us.
Yeah, I mean, the question is, and I'm looking at two different things here, and it's not addressed in this book at this point in time, of whether or not it's a majority or whether it's, as the judge says, is a super majority of 66.
It's a physical court, and there are five members, four members, and a county judge, which is a physical court. And that'd be 60%, so I'm not gonna like that. No member should be expelled by less than two-thirds of the vote. On voting, and they ain't done it.
Read that.
They got 60%.
Read that. Expelled two-thirds. It's just another way you're saying.
By less than two-thirds.
You got it back.
You're saying that one two-thirds.
Expelled.
You're saying it takes two-thirds to kick him out.
Right.
No, that's what you just read.
That's just what you're saying. It takes 66%. I'm reading in detail.
To kick him out.
To remove.
All right, go for a vote.
Does anybody have the article section and the section that you're reading?
I'm going to remove him and then don't worry about
it. No, you're not.
What's on?
Yeah, me, I'm on.
I'm going.
Who said that? That's another one I want to look at. Who said that? I know the article. Who? You said it, Chris?
No, I never. What was that?
Somebody said it. We're just part of every part of our yard.
I swear to your paranoia.
Yeah, we're in place, we're in place.
I never heard that.
I never. The paranoia saw the other one.
Must be on drugs.
Must be.
Let me call you one thing.
You got that corner, baby? I got this.
He's up there.
Oh, beautiful day.
I'm going to consider a motion to take a 15-minute break while I get over this one thing and combine with the county attorney.
Donnie's not going. Who's Donnie going? About 15 minutes to figure it out. He has to take 15 minutes, right?
We're resuming back at 11:30. We have to take a vote? Okay. I make a motion to take a 15-minute break recession. We have a second.
Wait on that one.
No, Darrell?
Aye.
remember it to you last time, ready, remember? No, last time when I called him with the dollar, you came back.
I told y'all to settle down, and you did, you went forward with the mayor, I asked you to settle down, and you did, you went forward with the mayor.
You didn't call Brent, you didn't talk to Rick Hill. That day?
Yes, I did, he laughed.
What'd you say?
He didn't say anything like this before, he didn't know the answer. Okay, we have figured out, it's up to the vote of the assembly, and it's whether or not it's a majority vote, or it takes 60%. I'm asking you, from what you read there, what article of Robert's Rules of Order are you reading?
I give you that, yeah.
What is it? I'll pull it up here, that's from what Magistrate Bush is giving.
But it says no less than two-thirds of the vote, what is no less than two-thirds, 56%, right?
What is it, what then?
Yeah, and that's to, so you have to have three votes to remove, correct?
Right, 66% before.
We'd have to have 66, two-thirds, then 66%.
But is that, but three sections, that to remove or repeal?
That is to.
Compel means remove, correct?
Hold on here, it's Article number 75, from the members of society. And it is, Article 13, legal right to assembly and trial of the members. Article number 75. And claim to get, take or move without less than two-thirds of the vote. That would be 66%. Two-thirds of you. You can't expel by less than two-thirds. 66%, right?
What did you say?
Less than.
You're saying it takes 66% to remove. All right, that means it would take four votes to remove Donnie Bush.
Right.
Three out of five.
Sixty.
Two-thirds out of 100 is 66.
Right.
That's right.
Take the vote.
They ain't got it.
We got four, Joe, we got three, we got four. Two-thirds is three. Remember, you got four, remember?
By less than two-thirds, y'all ain't got two-thirds of the vote to move.
Ain't either.
No, either move, no member shall be expelled by less than two-thirds.
That's what that says, you have to have three votes to.
Maybe we should ask Google.
And then you have four votes.
You have to have 66% to throw them out.
This is why nothing's get done in this county. Right there.
Have you read it, Brandon? You on our.
I can't find it.
Church, the church.
I'm trying to bring it up here.
Boy, y'all don't just look across at me, I'll call Brandon.
Legal right of assembly and trial of their members, Article 13. You know, the 75, it says trial of members of society.
Okay, I have it here now.
Now you forgot what you throwing out for.
Rick.
Come on, guys, please, let's not make this any more difficult.
All right, I'm sorry.
Let these guys.
I'm gonna make a motion to go in recess for 30 minutes. And do have a motion.
You just voted on one.
Have a motion? Do we have a second? Take a 30-minute break. One second.
And really, this is talking about trials. Hearings on misdeeds by members of, it's like a member of Congress that's committed crimes.
I'm on the ground. If they choose not to, they can go in.
Was that your jackpot?
This is about a trial.
Okay, go type in where it said remove in a.
And no member may be taken, may be expelled from the assembly, even if this applies to it, but less than a two-thirds vote. That talks about the assembly expelling someone from life to senate or the fiscal court, and you have to have over a two-thirds vote. That would mean four of the people have to vote upon that. Okay? So that's, if charges are brought, if formal charges are brought before the assembly, you have a trial on it, and the members of the assembly, the same as the impeachment stuff, is the members of the assembly have to vote, and you have to have a two-thirds vote to expel the person from the assembly. I think, although this is talking about meeting, this is talking about removal from office.
But wouldn't the point be, most, I mean, if it's three or four, either way?
If that applies, then.
Even if it's 366, what if it matters?
I mean, my understanding was, from my conversations, was it was a majority for a meeting, and so the majority's not present, but to remove, and I'm talking about removal from the assembly here, this appears to be talking about that would require 66% to remove, and that's, that means you would have to have four of the people voting to remove in this type of assembly, and I would think that Magistrate Bush should be disqualified to vote. So that makes it a possibility, more than likely, if the members vote as anticipated.
I'm not ready, Chair. Again, I'm gonna file a grievance here when this is over, but against these boys for trying to bribe her into, what to deal with.
So the county attorney's opinion is
that it takes a 66, and even going on the judge's argument, it takes a 66% to remove, if that isn't minimal. So at this point in time, we should go forward with me and stay. And I want to please act with the court.
You understand what he's saying, Judge?
I do, but I don't know how it is, but I mean, if that's how he sees it.
Come on, we're a little. He's pushing, just leaving him alone.
Come on, guys. Come on, guys. Get through.
Yeah, please, get through the meeting. We amended her proposed budget on her salary, on her deputy clerks. Same she had last year, $205,000.
We are here, then, so accept the motion, the way Donnie has read it.
With two line items changes, that's line item number 41, line item number 52.
You got no change, Chris? Okay.
And the budget will be on.
Do we have a motion, to do everybody that Donnie read it?
Line item basis.
We have a motion.
Motion.
Second.
Roy Darrell.
No.
Ray Moore.
Aye.
Al Changer.
Aye.
Donnie Bush.
Aye.
Okay. The next one, I'd like to go ahead and take one in. I got a copy, I didn't get a copy of the sheriff's budget until yesterday evening. Went to the hospital and tried to look through this thing. I've got too many questions to take up half a day.
So you say you just now got the sheriff's proposed budget, man?
Yeah, I'd rather we might have a meeting.
Did you receive it?
To do his, the budget.
Yesterday? You say yesterday, when you say?
Yesterday, when I, Bridget got me up. Well, I sent her over yesterday morning, and the sheriff didn't have it, he did. The treasurer, for some reason, if he didn't have a copy of it, he'd give you a copy. I didn't get a copy of his, but, here's the reason I wanna go ahead and table it and come back to it. Let me get my stuff here, 2019, 19. Ray Clemmons, when he was the sheriff, he had a maximum salary set at $65,000. Yesterday, last year, we talked about how much money we had saved and everything, and you all give him a the previous, the judge, the sheriff we got right now, y'all amended his budget up to $150,000. I think that went a little far out, but now this budget that I looked at last night, it got him up to $240,000. And I just haven't had time to look through it, and I hate to.
When you get time to look through it, you'll find out that the AOC is about $79,000for that $240,000.
Now, you don't have to look at, you don't have to.
He's reimbursed for that, so.
You're on the verge.
I'm trying to explain to you, Judge.
You're trying to blame your opinion. I can read a budget, and I have read, and I have.
But you ain't had time to look it over yet.
And I haven't had time to look it over. I got it yesterday evening, and I haven't looked over it good enough to. I've looked at it, but I just can't see where the number's coming from without looking at myself, and I'd like to go ahead and move that one, and we'll come back to it at a later date after I've looked at it. We still got plenty of time to do it.
It should've been turned in to DOG by 15th January, but that's me.
Next one is P is consideration and approval for road foreman, and I wanna bring Clarence Bailey and the road foreman. And said his pay is the same thing the last two foremen had back 8 years ago.
What's that amount?
$54,000, I think it's $416 or something like that. I'm gonna make a motion, and I'll second. I'm gonna second the motion. Ellis Changer.
No.
Donnie Bush.
No.
Roy Darrell.
Aye.
Ray Moore.
No.
I vote aye also, let the motion fails.
Judge, what is the salary?
And then. Yeah. And Laura, she's here.
Yes.
Okay, next thing is a resolution. And again, I am gonna be zero tolerance on drugs, but I'm also, my main concern is safety in this county. These roads, y'all chose back in June to make a call July 1st, and gravel. Then you finally came around and bought $2,000 for gravel for each district. That's around seven loads a district.
November 26th meeting.
I didn't ask you. I know what. It's seven loads a district. We have got right at 500 square miles. We're the second biggest county geographically in the state. So if y'all wanna know how per seven loads of gravel goes, figure it up. You can figure it up, I'm pretty sure.
For a month, Judge.
But for a month, that's exactly right. Hey, let me talk here. You got a resolution in front of you, you can vote on it. But again, I have put a resolution together. I have got 15, and I can check my email today. Waste Connection has sent me a list of 15 places that they, roads that they will not go on because they can't get a firm back out, pick up trash. If they don't get it picked up, it's gonna go in the creek, it's gonna be a mess, it's gonna be an illegal dump, it's gonna be something that, when I was a kid growing up, I was sick of seeing dumps and stuff drove over the hill, and I think we have made leaps and bounds. I'm gonna keep it clean. But if people can't get their trash picked up, they're not going to pay their bill, and they're gonna throw it over the hill and burn it. Drain pipe. Y'all will all forget drain pipe, put it in. Then when you need a drain pipe, the treasurer took upon himself with the directions of the master tyson, or the three masters, to go ahead and put a letter together. And he called the vendors and said, no more drain pipe unless they approve it. There wasn't no money in the budget.
I did not call them.
And then the one that I got a copy of, the treasurer office had put it together and sent it to Crystal, and then it got to me somehow. But I don't know who put it together.
I got a question about
that. But hold on, you can ask questions, let me get it out so I don't forget what I want to say. Again, I have got a resolution brought up here. I am a county judge. On the first few days Mick was in here, he took it upon himself by the guidance of the master to call Hinkle, saying there's no money for the budget for the gravel. If you let it go, they won't. I have to have a truck going down, I have to come back empty. The road department I have to control the road department to keep these roads safe, and they're not safe. I've got buses. I've got a list to turn around. I've got some buses that the bus can't even get up right now and refuse to go when the parents are having to bring the kids out to get on the bus. I think that's unacceptable.
Why can't you? You act road supervisor, we allocate gravel.
Hey, I'm talking, Wanky Fix, they bought $2,000 for each district.
A month, Donnie.
That's seven loads.
That was in November, this is.
That was seven loads.
This is the end of January.
That was seven loads.
You just got a month of gravel.
Hey, listen now, I'm already fed up with your company. But my resolution is to shut all county services except for those deemed necessary and daily operation by the Breath County Judge Executive. Whereas, and y'all got a copy of it there, whereas the Breath County Court has zeroed out the budget for county road department for gravel and drain pipe. In order to continue providing safety for these residents of Breath County, whereas the Breath County Court realizes it is no longer possible to keep a road safe for our children and citizens without unlimited amount of gravel and pipe. Y'all want to see what list of gravel and pipe I've got? You're welcome.
How many?
Whereas the court cannot come to terms on this agreement for the safety of our citizens to continue to provide this service for Breath County residents. And whereas the court desires to shut down all services to residents in Breath County in order to have control of the budget for gravel and drain pipe.
You shut the county down.
And I want you all to keep from shutting the county down. I want y'all to put $100,000 back in the budget for gravel, $25,000 for drain pipe. And only the county judge executive can call the vendors and cancel and delay services. It's not left to you all and the treasurer to call and say, hey, we're not going to pay if you don't give this. So it's my job to run the county, day-to-day operations. It's my job to illustrate the.
So you're going to pick and choose your roads, which you done, because the roads I.
That's a lie.
That ain't no lie.
You're turning it down.
Let me talk.
You turned in nine roads. Five of them are already on my list.
I don't give a damn if it was. You never put a gravel on one of them. Shut up, Roy, Darrell.
That's a lie.
That ain't no lie. I know where you put them. You put three loads on Hard Shell Canyon. You put two up there. I was right up there.
Did you not have right work for Hard Shell Canyon?
You just put in up there the other day.
Well, yeah.
One load out of seven.
That was on my list already.
And then you take one, since you mentioned gravel, you take one right below your house, a part of them nieces. One house over Butter Point Road. You gravel right to the
one
front.
House.
One house over there.
Really?
Yeah, really.
Well,
and then I got a pipe up there.
Jim O'Connell live on Butter Road. He's on the other side of the creek.
The other side, it's a river between that and the other side of the creek.
You think not Jim O'Connell, that Jim O'Connell.
I've been there a minute of a time, mister.
Who lives over there? One house?
Them nieces. One house up where that woman's husband died about 2 years ago.
You got Laura Campbell, you got her boy that lives at Cabin, you got Jim over boy that there, and you got Bessie Thomas.
Do they all live together?
You know how long he's been turned in and have gravel put on him?
How long?
Since June, buddy.
Well,
You should have put them on there. You all.
And I got a pipe. I got a pipe.
You
wouldn't touch it. Put that pipe in it with her. Why didn't you put it in?
I went up there and looked at that pipe.
Yeah.
I was going to take a long shot. Why? Y'all put a letter together said don't.
No. You went way before the letter got put together. I'm sorry.
No, I didn't.
I know you did. Alan Strong said you come right up there and talk to his boy about that pipe. That was four days before we ever shut the pipe.
Me and you going to go see Alan. I talked to his boy over at the ball game last week.
We can go see anybody you want to.
And I'm telling you.
It's your problem. You don't want to go take nobody and see nobody. You going to go make all the calls. I have a list.
Hold on.
And the way you run this county is bullshit. So it's my heart, son. You're not president.
I ain't looking for no gravel to be wasted. You put them where you want to. Nobody else gets none.
Hold on.
I don't care about your list. You got just like stamping for them. How many loads you put them stamping for?
That's what six laws.
Yep. It's that deep. Well, you done a good job on it.
No, you aren't gonna, you ain't been up there.
I've been up there. I was up there the other day. Don't tell me I ain't
you,
been up there.
You can't turn up there to hit the holler there.
No, because they're logging now. They've been, they was logging when you grabbed it before. You know I ain't been up there.
District 1 has got $2,200 in gravel put on Roark Ridge, one load, one, two on North Rockley Road, Hurricane Frank, White Oak Creek Road, Chester Bailey Road, and our Fort Holler.
I mean, them loads on my list. I mean, it was on this out there then.
I don't know.
That same number you got, Bridget?
You jump just like Ray. You turned the list.
Oh, wait a minute. You had the same number you got, Bridget?
You turned the list in about a month ago.
Let's see Bridget's numbers, Judge. Let's see Bridget's numbers. Think I've got about two loads is what I got.
Okay, while y'all looking, I'll tell you what you got. I know what you got for. District number 2 has got 6 loads of timber for it. And it's around $1,585. District 3.
This one just took yesterday. Those 4 lots.
Those are not on the claims list.
District 3. They've got 2 loads at Hardshell County, 1 load at Butter Grove, 1 load at the Dry Fork of Hardshell County, Perkins and Frank slash Frank Road, and Frank only 2 loads more on the bank. That was on your list, I think. Upper River County Road and Harris Creek. There was another one on your list, that Harris Creek Road.
Jim, can I ask you a question?
And then District 4. District 4 has got how much is the mail on there? District 4 is 1925. It's got 7 on Roark Ridge.
That's a whole lot of different mud. Bridget, give me $1,300.
Where's the rest of the invoices at for the grant?
I'm going by the team.
And it actually been 9 loads in District 1. Now we took one to
took one to Hoover Drive yesterday.
Where at?
Hoover Drive.
Sure. Yep.
But I didn't know I had a ticket for Airplane Hollow, so that's not on my list. If I don't get the tickets, I'll have to.
Ray hauled that last week. Looked up Ray hauled that on the 22nd. You all hold up, that's your name here.
Yeah,
Ray Hall hold on the 22nd. Then the 22nd was Chester Bailey Road. That may have been on your list, Donnie, I'm not for sure.
It was.
And our Airplane Hollow was.
Y'all went on probably on the wrong end.
Chester Bailey Road.
Doug, could I ask a question? Has $2,000 worth of gravel been put in every district since that decision?
Now, hold on, I'm sorry, going right back over.
Has $2,000 worth of gravel been put in each district monthly since?
No, they just done it. They just
done it. They just done
one thing, and it was on the 26th day of November, I think, or December.
He is now getting around the hall.
But I thought it was voted on by everyone.
It was.
That the gravel would go directly to the district.
And it did. You got $2,200 District 1. You got $2,245. Let's see, you got
$2,425
in District 2.
In
District
3.
You got $2,080 in District 4 was $1,925. I'm sorry, District 2 was $1,585 with. Actually, District 1 got $4,280, but that included a FEMA project.
Right.
And then $900-some of a FEMA project in District 2. But this resolution, again, is to put $100,000 in the budget for gravel, $25 for drain pipe, and nobody can call and cancel the vendor or delay the service. And I want to consider an option to. For that resolution, you want to make a motion? Do we have a second? And the way I understand is if they, do we have a second?
Judge.
I'm going to second the motion on that.
Judge, what services would be cut in that resolution?
No services we cut. We just get down to the minimum that we need to operate the county and get to, I just need to concentrate on getting these roads in good shape, and a motion's been made by Roy Darrell, second motion.
You figure $8,000 a month, it comes about $96,000 a year, so it's no different.
Second page of the Breath County Administrative Code.
We should be spending that now.
Yeah, yeah.
That's already voted on.
It clearly states on the second page of Breath County.
So you already don't have no trouble doing it, just like you drain.
We don't have no trouble doing it.
According to.
What do you want to put the gravel in?
Well, who was the master of canceling the vendors from selling drain pipe in? Who was the one who put the letter together, this thing on the door outside?
Oh, you put it.
That's how it started.
Who decided to do that?
No.
Who told you to do it, Tim?
I'm sure.
No, the one thing I do want to clarify, I never contacted one vendor.
Who called the vendor?
I called the vendor, when I got the letter from you, I called the two vendors.
Like, I didn't ask the mayor, it didn't brought to me. That's how I found out about it, I was saying, can't get no more drain pipe.
I don't want the vendors to release that, so they'll get paid, why should I got the letter?
On the second page.
What's that got to do with, they tell you to call and can, do you give PO?
No, I don't.
Well, why did you call them, there would be no more PO?
Well, did you want the vendors to give out pipe and then I get paid for it?
That's why we do this right here.
According to KRS 68005, it clearly states in the Breath County Administrative Code, a judge executive must execute the policies and priorities as established by the fiscal court.
Y'all do that in a meeting to call the drain pipe, and we ain't gonna tell these people on the bus ball, we got a pipe up at, right up and down when you run over, the bus runs over.
Fix it.
Let them buy it like my niece did.
No, that's the trouble now, they've done that, then they took back order on it.
My niece had to pay $500 for it up on a county road, so she get her final post of Tahoe.
And I don't know if there are girls in here or not, but that road is still, that road in court, I talked to him again on.
Darrell is back there. Darrell wants to start some more sports.
Well, I'm naming to you this morning, the drain pipe up, Darrell, they didn't run water over because they couldn't get an easement because it was private property, my understanding.
You know, of course, I represent one side.
Right, that's right.
It's our position that it's not a county road. And you know, this issue came up several years ago in prior administration, and we asked them for any documentation they had that it was a private road, and they were unable to provide it. And I know through the litigation that's going on, we've asked for documentation that's a private road, and it still has not been provided. So it remains our position that it's not a private road, that it's not a county road.
Then how can we go by the roadway from Frankfurt on all county roads? Because we do not have paperwork on these county roads, am I right, Bridget?
You are right.
I think what we need to do on that road is go to the drain pipe, no confusion, and call the road department, tell them what it is, what it really is to the pipe, and deal with it.
Jeff, did you not talk to Scarlett Smith?
Yes, I did.
What'd you tell her?
I told her where we put that pipe in, if she needs that worked on, to call me.
And she did, you talked to her, what'd you tell her?
And I did, and I went up there to look, and I thought the car was dragging through the creek gravel, but it was as solid as it could be through the creek gravel. And then I went back a few days later, and they bought gravel up from the drain pipe up.
Did you tell her you would get her gravel up there, she needed it?
From the drain pipe back, I did tell her I'd work on it, I did tell her I'd take it to her house, no matter.
Where's your gravel?
To that District Two, and it ended up in Stamford Court.
Exactly.
And still got a bus that can't get up to Greenport. Hey, I'm gonna walk up to her house, it's in pretty good shape.
Don't promise what you can't.
Hey, don't tell me what to promise.
Well, that's my niece, and they had paid $500 out of their pocket for gravel, for county road.
That's another thing. I don't want to hear anything else about it.
Well, I'm sorry, and I will be asking the fiscal court to reimburse this child.
Hey.
I will be the receipt.
You go ahead, I ain't gonna put up with that. I ain't gonna put up with that.
You know what, but I can tell them when it's fast.
I made a motion, I have seconded.
And are you gonna take it to jail? Thank you, sir.
To do the resolution, are you, Roy Darrell? You're forward?
You all wanna shut the county down?
No.
Y'all voting to shut the county down?
$100,000.
Shut the county.
Tell the teacher.
No.
You voting on the resolution?
Donnie Bush?
No.
Now, the way I understand that, they didn't vote to put it, put put it in the budget, so I think them being against putting it in the budget would pass. Is that not right, Randy? Can you?
Do what?
What was the question? And I don't know about it.
What was the question?
They didn't vote to provide the drain pipe, put the money in the budget in the gravel. They voted against doing that. So the resolution, the way I understand it, the way it wrote up, if you vote against doing it, it will shut the county down. Is that right?
Well, I mean, just.
They didn't want to vote to give the money to put it in?
Once appropriated, you just have, I mean, as the voting board, as the judge, you have what you have to operate with. So that would be what services you provide is in your discretion under that based upon what's provided to you.
So what I, and that's what this whole resolution is about. When I need gravel and I need pipe, I don't need to, for the road secretary to have come say that, okay, go ahead and put a pipe up here. We'll put a pipe down here.
The funding, no, the funding is into the reserve control, reserve transfer. Gravel.
So y'all refusing to put any money in the budget? That's what y'all wanted to do, not to put money in the budget for gravel and drain pipe, right?
Refusing to put $100,000 in there.
You got the media resolution.
We've been amending the budget every week.
Why'd y'all stop the drain pipe about 2 weeks ago now, or whatever it was?
There's some issue on that, where was it, no matter or something.
Well, what's the issue? That's what I want to know. What was the issue?
Fact is, we allocated $2,000 per month back in November, and you're just now getting around the holiday here, it's almost February. So why is that?
Per month, is that how you're working?
Yes, per month. Back up, look at your minutes.
Okay.
You act like it's.
I'm gonna check it. It wasn't there that way either. You're dead wrong. You put $2,000 for each district, not monthly. Are you willing, are you, we carry on? I'll go to the taxpayers and they done that going on. Consideration approval to adopt Plum Creek, Boomer Lane, and Clem Lane into the county road plan. Have a motion.
Okay.
Have a second. I'll second that motion. Ellis Tensher.
No.
Donnie Bush.
No.
Roy Darrell.
Aye.
Ray Moore.
No.
Want some light to bring up for discussion, but consideration to pay or issue a check to Embassy Suite in amount of $755.55 for the deputy coroner. They got a training that's mandatory, February 2nd, I think it was, or the 7th or 8th. And need a motion to issue a check to take when he goes down. Do that motion.
Training, yeah.
Pardon? Yeah, training. It's something he has to have. He's a new hire.
Motion.
Have a second. Who says that, Ray or?
Ray.
Ray Moore.
Aye.
Ellis Tensher.
Aye.
Donnie Bush.
Aye.
Roy Darrell.
Aye.
Okay, discussion of the lease agreement, is that payable to the deputy coroner or to the hotel? That was for the hotel, Embassy.
So it's payable to the hotel?
Yeah, Embassy Suite.
Excuse me. Legitimate question.
You just have a call, Richard. Okay, Darrell Earl, you want to go ahead and take the lead off your go? I didn't know you were going. Thank you, Richard.
I'm here on behalf of J.L. Smith Enterprises. Of course, he owns this building over here at 420 Jet Drive. We've talked about it a little bit before. When he purchased that building, he got the bill sale for it. He thought he'd be able to move the building, but as it turns out, he's not. It's impossible to move it without destroying the building. So he is proposing a lease to the county for the property that the building sits on. He is proposing, I'll draft you the proposed lease, just like each one of you had this there in front of you. It is a long-term lease. Of course, he'd be responsible for everything on the property. don't know if you've had a chance to look at that, if you have specific questions or not, but he is seeking to lease that property that the building sits on.
And what I would like to do, and I think it's to Mr. Hurley this morning, I'd like y'all to take that and look at it, let's not make it, take any action on it today. I've actually got a lady coming from Frankfurt next Wednesday. We understand that there're gonna be 12 places to get your driver's license renewed and this updated thing. They're no longer gonna do it, the way I understand it, they need the circuit court building. They're gonna have a building just for that. She's wanting to know if we have a building to look at, and this is just speculation, and I haven't discussed it with anybody except her just a little bit this morning. They really wanted to be in town. When we did our last meeting, somebody made a recommendation or made a comment about maybe the senior citizens could go to the Montessori school. And after I thought about it, I think that would be one of the absolutely best things we could do. And what my proposal is, or what I'd like for y'all to think about, if the driver's license company would be interested in where the senior citizen building is, they'd be willing to draw, it'd be a long-term lease thing. Maybe let them have lease some senior citizen building that we now have, and maybe look at even purchasing the building that JL had over there. He'd give us a price, and then Darrell would come up with his lease agreement to put together last week.
And I'm assuming that irregardless of which avenue was chosen, if either one of them are, that there would probably have to be some probably be some appraisals done, I imagine, for the, you know, either the rental value or the purchase value. So I guess to maybe to move this along, we would at least ask if the court would consider maybe starting that appraisal process.
I think we need to do that either way on that, because even if we did purchase it, we couldn't do this, but they could also say this is reasonable and not to release the property that it's sitting on.
I guess best we can do it, right?
I would entertain a motion to do just that. Go ahead and start the process of having it evaluated. The building evaluated what it would be worth or what it would be worth that the building sits there. And we would have that, whichever way we choose, we still need to have that done before we can do the lease agreement according to the statute. But I'd entertain a motion to do just that. Wouldn't want anybody to come in and do evaluation on that.
And make a motion.
Second.
Okay. House plus the.
Pardon?
You doing the rental house plus the.
Yeah.
Property.
The property. See how much it's worth to let the building sit there, and then see how much the building worth to prefer.
The rental house, the property valuation.
Okay, go ahead, Raymore made the motion, Donnie seconded it. Go ahead, Raymore.
Aye.
Donnie Wood.
Aye.
Motion carries. Okay. DLZ, Eric Grant.
Just want to say thank you to this board for allowing us to perform this feasibility study for y'all. For those who don't know, back towards the end of October, this board hired DLZ for a full-service engineering and design firm to do a study on this building. I don't think it's going to come as any shock to anybody that there are issues with this building. So during this study, we were looking at a couple of things. First of all, can this building be updated and fixed to address some of the mechanical, electrical, structural issues that you have going on with this building? It's a fairly old building, seen a lot of wear and tear over time. After that, we needed to look at whether or not, what it would cost to bring this building up to a usable functionality. And then also, if not, what would it cost to build a new building that would act as a county administration building for all the offices that are located here in the courthouse now? What would that cost? What would it look like? What kind of programming space would you need in that to cover the judge, treasurer, county clerk, PBA, all these different offices that are here? So we went through that process, met with some of the folks here in the courthouse, talked about what was needed. We sent a team down of our engineers and architects to review the building. You'll see in the presentation a lot of photographs that we've taken of problem issues that have to be addressed if you want to move forward. But as I said, there's, you know, we've known for some time is there's been a couple of studies on the mold issue here in the building. It's present, obviously, on the walls. So we knew that there were going to be some issues going in based on the study we've seen already. And we'll kind of, Eric Ratz, who is our principal architect in charge, will kind of explain where we started, how we got there, what we found, and what your options are moving forward. Eric?
Thanks, Sean. All right. Good morning, everyone. Good afternoon. Thank you for the opportunity to work with Breathitt County. I think there's been a lot of people that's been involved in the overall process, and I do appreciate all the time and effort that some folks have put into it. I know the magistrates, fiscal court, and some others, I've heard they do have some books, and we'll leave some extra copies with this. But I think it's important just take a few minutes to walk through that what we've been doing over the past several months. And I think that to explain a little bit about what a feasibility study is something that is important. A feasibility study, to me, is the most important process or the most important step in the entire project that you might be taking into account. Because what happens in the feasibility study, can you adjust that a little bit? The feasibility study is really what is where you take your time, take as long as absolutely as necessary, but that's where you're going to determine what are the real needs. What is that scope of work? How much is it going to cost? And then how long will it take? And so it is anytime you go through any type of a project, specifically when you're spending lots of money on a project, is make sure that you do it right for the first on the first step. It's like having that recipe that you're getting ready to make something. You want to make sure that everybody's on board with what the direction is on this. We have the owner needs, and then what we do as an architect is that we, as the design team, we listen. And then what we're doing is we're listening, we're observing, and then we can communicate back to you really on a living document that translates what your needs are into a product that would be best for Breathitt County for long term. So our process for study is really a four-step process, and I'm going to walk you through a little bit of each one of what these are. Phase one is a project recognition. It's to understand why do we need to do something. Okay, and we're going to walk you through why we need to do something that's really a basis of walking through this building multiple times, looking at your existing conditions, and understanding what those items are. Phase two is a needs assessment. That's where we sit down with all the different department office holders to understand how much space do you need? Not how much do you want, but how much do you need to make sure that you're looking forward for the next 50 plus years. You know, this building is almost 60 years old. I would expect your next building to serve at least that amount of time as well. So this is a multi-generational decisions that we're making. Phase three is a facility program development, and that's where we take what all the discussions we had and we turn it into a program. And the program, I'll talk about it here in a few minutes more in depth, but the program is the number of spaces, how big they are, where should they be, the space adjacencies with it. And then phase four is the project definition and the implementation plan. That's really where it starts to talk about how much would something like this cost? Where might it go? And how long does it take to do that? And those are the other items that we're talking about here. I think as much as anything is understanding there is no decisions being made by the fiscal court to go spend X amount of dollars to do a project, that what we're trying to do here is to generate an awareness of, hey, we need to do something. Also, then you start to build a consensus. And once the members here, they wrap their arms around it, they understand what we're doing, then you start to build a consensus over a period of time. Sometimes it takes years, sometimes it takes months, but we've got to make sure that we're moving forward for the right decisions. So phase one, the project recognition, I am not going to go through this because of all these in detail, because it's rather obvious of what your conditions here in the building are. The things that we looked at are multiple trips through the building is we looked at what we call the architectural or the general items, and that is the condition of the building, the materials, the finishes throughout the overall process. We also look at the site. What is the conditions around the site, specifically stormwater? How do we handle drainage? How do we handle parking? How do we handle ADA compliance? The mechanical portions, the heating, the cooling. is it, you're gonna see that's a lot cooler in the hallway than it is in this room, okay? And it's just balancing what those items are. I'm also, obviously, the plumbing issues. The building is not a sprinkled building, doesn't have a fire sprinkled building, and that's what the fire protection is. And then from the electrical, take one thing and count here. 60 years ago when this building was built, they didn't have these things throughout the building, okay? All right, they didn't have computers. And I think that, you know, the attorney sitting up here is probably feeling a lot of the heat that's off of the projector, off the computers and things, that goes into a building, and it's really not accounted for in the overall mechanical design. And that's why you have some issues in older buildings if they have not been extensively renovated. So the purpose of this is really to document what the existing conditions are. And again, these are the slides. You have all the information. I'm not going to go through each and every one of these very specifically about it. Some of the things I do want to point out is that this is not a report where we knock holes in walls, knock holes in ceilings to see what's behind concealed conditions. It's more of a visual observation of what your systems and finishes are throughout the overall building. Noted, you know, this building, like I said, is built 62, 63. It's approaching 60 years old. And there have been some improvements to the overall building, but not dramatic improvements to a lot of different things. I will say that back in the late 50s, when the folks were talking about some type of project, is you did make some very good decisions at that point in time. You know, the trousel floors out here will last another, who knows how long. It will last hundreds of years if it's maintained. So I think that one of the things about this is that you've got good use out of your building. But again, it is 60 years old, and there are some limitations in the building that we'll be talking about here. There were obviously some structural improvements around the building, where you see the lintels and the tube steel columns that go around to help support some of the failure of the exterior envelope of the building. And then obviously out in front, there was a foyer addition that was done about 20 years ago with that. You know, just looking at just some basic ideas throughout the building, is there's, as a lot of you are probably aware of, the American with Disabilities Act that's literally almost 30 years old, okay? In 1992, buildings that were built 92 and later had to take into play the conditions of folks with disabilities. And they need to state, a disability is not just a person in a wheelchair. Okay, it could be like my father right before he passed, is that he used a cane. Okay, it could be someone that's blind, it could be someone that's just on crutches. It's a lot more than just someone in a wheelchair. So just to look at that. You do have some ways to get into the building, but obviously your main steps coming into the building are not ADA compliant or handicap accessible with that. It's a public facility, it should be, okay? Along the lines with that. We do have some ADA accessible stuff. The signage could be better. That's something that can easily be done. But that's, you know, something that should be addressed. You know, out here, there are some drainage problems out there. You know, it's a wonderful memorial space out there, but there are some drainage issues with that. Simple things that, you know, this isn't to point out all the problems in the building, by no means at all, but it's just talking about some things that could be improved in the building. If you're not careful with handrails, if you don't keep them painted, you don't keep sealants on, they will start to rust. And if they start to rust, then they will start to fail, and then it can become a safety issue along those lines. Sidewalks, you have to always make sure that when you have bad concrete, bad pavement areas, that those things get repaired, because it's just like with I know you guys talked about county roads and stuff, and not to get into that, but once a road starts to fail, if you don't take care of it, it will just compound and grow very fast on how something will do with that. Roof condition, I believe it's about 8 or 9 years old. It's in good condition. You've got at least another dozen years that you probably shouldn't have any worries about your roof at all. But there are items up on the roof that you need to maintain, paint, do some other things just to make sure that they also prolong their lives. One thing that most any building, one thing that is always the case, is the ceilings that go around windows, doors, there's some in brick joints and stuff. Ceilings never get replaced. And unfortunately, in 7 to 10 years, they should be replaced. And what happens is when a sealant fails, it's just like a asphalt road. When you get a crack, water gets down in it, the freeze-thaw cycle, then you get
potholes, chuck holes throughout the road. Same thing happens with the sealants. When they fail, water gets inside your brick cavity wall, and then mold and other things can start to grow along lines with that. Just some other things throughout the building. We do start to see a lot of cracks. We've seen a lot of rusting. Some of the things around where you put in some of the structural improvements on the exterior, just some things that need to be improved. We know that the county made the decision at the lower level, you're not using it now. And that's a good decision because there are a lot of problems in the lower level. It's unfortunate. You need the square footage. You need the spaces to make it all work. But the lower level is just something that needs a whole lot of work on to be safe and to be able to work down into space. You start to look at the overall finishes in the building, some of them need to be replaced, or a lot of them need to be replaced. But it's just one of those things that throughout the course of a building, it's no different than your home, your carpeting at home. So many years, you got to replace it just because it starts to show wear and tear with that. But some of the concerns, you know, when we start to see water damage, basically what's happened is when you have exterior walls, you start to see the paint peel. Water gets in from the exterior, it gets in the wall, and it's just the moisture that's in the wall, and that's why the paint doesn't adhere to the walls. I mean, you start to see that throughout. One of the things I noted, this is a good example, the door handle here. That's something that's not ADA compliant. It has to be the lever type. Just think of someone that might not be able to turn a door knob. That's what a lot of us might say with that. Restrooms, I know we've got some grab bars and some restrooms, but they're not totally ADA compliant. It's not just the stalls or the partitions where you use the restroom. It's also then how your means of egress of getting in and out of the space, your path of travel with that. Just some various different things, ADA compliant issues that would need to be brought up to speed if you do a renovation of the overall building. From a mechanical point of view is that most of the things are in pretty fair condition. There are some components of the system that might need to be replaced, but overall, not taking on the account addressing humidity issues, which is, for example, like in this room, when you start to see the ceiling panels, like in the corners where they start to go up, what happens is there's higher humidity in the space. The ceiling panels, over a course of time, they get heavier, and they start to bow down in the middle. And that's why you start to see some of the things with that. Down the basement, we got a lot of ventilation issues. We got conditions of units in the basement that really needs to be replaced. Then also up on the first and second floor, we got some of them that just are not operating to the level that they should, and also the level of what the building code would state with that. We do have some newer DX tooling items in the sheriff's area and do some things with that. We also do see that there is a lot of dehumidifiers in the building to address the humidity issues. And you also have some exhaust fans that are in fair condition, just exhaust out of the spaces too often. What happens, not saying it happened here in Brunswick County, but too often for energy consumption, they'll turn off the exhaust fans just so that you're not spending the monies on them, or they don't, exhaust fans don't get repaired. But those are important to keep the movement of air in the various different locations with that. Highly recommend, I've been doing this for 33 years, I highly recommend that any building that you have, that you own, that you occupy, that you make sure that you have a sprinkler system in the building. Okay, it will help dramatically with your insurance rates and also will protect your building in case there's anything along with those. Probably a lot of your piping throughout the building is original, which would be very common, but you're going to start to need to see some improvements in some of those items from a piping point of view with that. Again, the indoor air quality issues, it's just a product of the age of the building, just something that really needs to be addressed throughout the building. And again, this is something that starts to show the ceiling panels, just for an example, in this room, the humidity with that. One of the things you will see in older buildings is you'll see a lot of folks that are using temporary little heat sources at their desk, at their workstation, to keep them warm. And that's just all part of the heating system throughout the building to make sure all the spaces are conditioned correctly. I'm sure that the exterior walls are not the R value that we would expect today to meet the Indian, or to meet the energy code with how we design buildings today. Electrical, it's really, you know, your incoming service. Again, we didn't have computers, we didn't have a lot of systems that we have in the building back in the early 60s that we do today. There's a lot of things that probably we had overextended what the true power needs in the building are, and should be looking at some things to address that. Probably a lot more outlets are needed in some spaces, more technology and abilities to do some of those things. You know, you do start to see in some locations, not all, but you could have some more energy efficient lighting in a lot of locations. It would help a lot with the amount of what we call foot candles. That's how bright the space is. It would also help with the energy consumption throughout the building along those lines. Several locations throughout the building, it's just some maintenance issues, and it's not necessarily something that can't be taken care of, but you get a lot of locations where the device plates or outlets, they've been broken and they just haven't been replaced. There's some things along those lines that can be taken care of relatively easily. Some of the items throughout is making sure that your fire alarm system is up to date, that you're having no issues with that, and that includes exiting and all your lights. These lights go off and you have lights that pop on to address those, but again, those are things that can be taken care of. So that was just a synopsis real quick, and we'll wrap all this up here in a minute, but for phase one, it was really walking through the interior and the exterior of the building to understand what that is. The phase two, again, is where we met in this room, also some other rooms throughout the building, to talk about really what are some of the needs of spaces in the building. And I would say that every group that we met with, they came with a laundry list. They came with things that be able that they can provide their service better, but also then help visitors to the space that they can come in and they can also learn to use your building in a much better way. So what we did was we did a summarize in each one of the areas that talked about who the group was. We also started to identify all the spaces, how many of those spaces, what a square footage for each one of those spaces were, and then we dedicated, for example, the coroner's office, 1,400 square feet. And we went through and we did the same thing for the EOC, the Emergency Operations Center, the county court clerk, sheriff's office, the jailer, the PVA, the judge, executive, county treasurer, the fiscal court. We put all that in together into one space. And then the water district along the lines with that. So when we take all those things together, what those square footages that we came up with is what we call, and this is an important note here because you're going to see something.
You'll need to provide space for the county attorney too. I have my entire staff in a separate private
building
in my home, but it needs to be the county attorney.
Okay. Yeah, and I'll explain a little bit where there might be a room or space or something for that coming up.
It's not a room or space. We have the biggest office, the number of people in the whole
Okay.
So child support plus that. But the reason we're not here is because the problem with the downstairs.
Okay. So we can adjust. It's a good comment. So a couple of different things we look at, you're going to see what's called a net square footage and a building square footage, and it's very different. A net square footage is something where we would take a tape measure and we would measure the width and the length of this room. Okay, we're not taking into account of any hallways, restrooms, mechanical space, the thickness of the walls. That's really the net square footage. And then to get to a gross square footage, which is where we would measure the footprint of the building on the exterior, that takes care of everything. Stairs, elevator, toilet rooms, mechanical, electrical rooms, all your hallway space within the different various offices, et cetera, along those lines. Very different square footages, and that's why you'll see something here in a minute. So whenever we took all of the, minus the county attorney, when we take all these spaces here, we come up with a net square footage of about 15,000 square feet. And then when we start to look at what we call the grossing factor, the factor that gets us to the overall building footprint, there's approximately 7,200 square feet that we added to that. And what that would get us to is 22,515 square feet to meet all the needs, plus the county attorney to add to that space that you would need to look at if you were going to replace this building or if you were going to do an expansion to this building. But within the county, within these various different areas here, this is how much square footage that you would need to be able to replace in kind. Also looking at not just replacing for today, but also then looking out for the next 50 years of what types of spaces you might need to grow and how each one of those areas can grow. So with that, one of the things that we had talked about in a couple of our meetings was looking at a site right down the street here, literally half a block away, in this location here. We're currently here looking at a location over here, and there's currently a parking lot in essence there right now. So one of the things is, you know, you can start to see just a visual of it. Also understanding there's a pretty big drop off, just like everything else around here. There's, with the grade change, there's a pretty big drop off. So if you start to look at the overall square footage of the building, if you look at the site there and you look at some other things, you have to start to kind of look at what everything would be. So if we were looking at approximately a 22,500 square foot building on that site, you would have to look at where it would be a two-level facility. And with a lower level and then a street-level facility with that. If you went to a three-level facility, your square footage numbers would probably go up just a little bit because you'd have a little bit more of some circulation space, some duplication of restrooms, and those types of things. But you would look at approximately about 7,500 square feet per floor if you did that approach with that. So, you know, one of the things we always look at is that when you start a design project, you need to identify who all the utilities are to make sure that we've got the necessary utilities at the site. And once, if that would be the site we would look at, we could start to identify what those items are. But we always want to make sure that we know who those folks are up front with that. So in identifying if it's a two-level facility, and I will call it the street level, and then I will call it the other level with that. But we had went through and we identified what spaces could be on one level, and then on another level, we identified what spaces would be with that. If we went to a third level facility, may need to alter just a little bit, obviously, to look at some of the things, but we looked at the folks that who we felt would be the best to be adjacent to each other, versus who could be on a separate level. It doesn't mean that there might not be someone here that really should also be over here, but we also have to balance the overall square footages. And I think that in how we balanced it, we were within 15 square feet, literally 15 out of 22,000 square feet, we were within about 15 square feet of being able to balance those on those two levels with that. That grossing factor I talked about really defines what the items are in this location here. Some of the items to consider, site preparation, it's a two-level facility, working into a downtown environment, if this would be the location. Obviously the downtown architecture, as you went through your new building project adjacent here, just what the building might look like in the area. Public parking, staff parking, it's always an issue. Okay, especially wherever you're at in a downtown facility, but you know, here in Jackson, I mean, parking is an issue, and it's just trying to address what those things are. I know that between the coroner and the sheriff and jailer and stuff, that there was some direction on potentially doing a vehicle sally port so they could bring a vehicle into a garage in essence, shut the door to be able to do some things. And then obviously, the thing that drives everything is the cost of a project. How much money do we have for a project? How can we finance it? How can we move forward? Some things to consider on that particular site is construction staging. And a construction staging means is that deliveries of equipment and materials on the job site. You have to have some place to stage that stuff such that when they're installing stuff, it has to be stored somewhere on site with that. Traffic flows. I'm sure there was probably a couple headaches when the building was built, being built next door here. Utility coordination, typical things with building permits locally here, as well as the state level, just getting approved in the downtown area, and then also trying to determine what is the best way to do this project. And the delivery method is how do you solicit the architect, the construction, design build, construction management. There's a whole lot of different ways that are advantageous for the county for a particular project like this. This slide is maybe one of the, besides that feasibility study defining what that is, I think that this may be the second most important slide for everybody to really understand. And it's how do you determine what a cost is for a building? There are three very, very distinct different things. And I bring this up because when you go to the next county and you say, how much did that project cost? It's understanding what number they're giving you, okay? You have the hard construction cost number. That's one number. The hard construction cost is how much you can expect on bid day. You read some numbers off here today. Is how much does it cost to build the building? To build the walls, to build the floors, the mechanical system, the electrical system, to actually pay the contractors to bid, build the building. That's one number. Second number is the cost of doing business. For example, you go buy a new car for $22,000. Then you get the processing, you get the destination, you get the handling, you get this, you get that, you get a loan on the car, there's interest rates, and you got to pay other things. All those other things are that soft cost. Okay, and it's something that, you know, and it gave a whole laundry list of things through here, what those soft costs are. And then the third thing is the fiscal court, when they have to budget monies to do the project, they're not just budgeting $5 million to go build the building. There's also maybe $1 million worth of soft costs. They have to budget $6 million. And I'm just using that as an example, $6 million. But when you get bids for the project and they come in at $5 million, it's not under budget because there's all these extra things that you always have to pay for a project. So when you go to the next county and you ask someone, hey, you're going to build a 22,000 square foot building, you ask them, did it cost you $5 million or did it cost you $6 million? So just whenever you're out talking to people, try to make sure that you relate the question of how much did it cost to build the building or how much did you finance to do the project. I don't want to overstate that any more than that, but it's just something as you start to compare, is you really need to understand what that number is that you're asking for and make sure that one county to the other county is giving you the same information. Because one county may say, my building costs $5 million. And you talk to someone else in the county and they'll say, it costs $6 million, and you get confused. So, very different, but it's important to know what those are. So one of the things we did is we went through and we said, okay, we're going to renovate this building. We're going to come in, we're going to try and get another 30, 40 years out of this building. We're going to look at all the mechanical, the electrical, the plumbing systems in the building. We're going to address the exterior items, the interior items, the finishes, the ADA compliance. We're going to address the air quality. We're going to address all of that such that everybody can use this building for X amount for the next 30, 40 years, okay? Also keep one thing in mind that is paramount with this is that to do a project like that, you really best would be to vacate the building, okay? We have been through courthouses where historic courthouses built in the late 1800s where we would vacate half of the building, do the work, and then move to the other half of the building. Ideally speaking, you would move out, come in, renovate the whole building, and then you would move back in. It's not always possible, but that would be the ideal situation with that. And to renovate the building to the extent that it needs to be, going back to the hard construction cost, is that you're going to be somewhere in the neighborhood of $4 to $4.5 million. And a lot of it is just because of the extensive amount of replacing those systems, that mechanical, the plumbing, the electrical systems. Because when you do that, you come in, you tear down all the ceilings, you replace all the duct work, you do the new temperature controls, you do the new lighting, you put the sprinkler system in, then you gotta come back and put the ceilings in, okay? So there's just a lot of work that whenever you go through the size of the building to be able to renovate all of it, to be able to get what those costs are. And then based on that, your project cost, and this is an approximate number, it'd have to be something working with the financial advisor to get a lot more involved, be somewhere in the neighborhood of a little over $1 million to handle those things. So again, to look at a new construction. New construction is going to cost a little bit more, okay? Not substantially more by any means. It's also a little bit bigger building, okay? Because this is somewhere in the neighborhood of about 18,000, 19,000 square feet, or this is based on 22,000 square feet. So it's not a complete apple to apple, but this is something that looks at extending the building, you know, multi-generational building that's going to address not only just your needs today, but also in the future. So this gets to be the 4.7, a little over $5 million per construction cost. And then you have a number for soft cost. it's a little more, this number's a little bit more, so soft costs have to be also a little bit more along those lines with that. What I would note very clearly is if you go to another site, it does not include, if you go to another site, if there's any environmental issues on that site, okay? Whatever it may be, we did not do a site investigation specifically of items under the ground to look at that. If there's any building demolition, those costs are usually a little bit above that, not astronomical, but just something else that you might need to think about with that. So with that is the other thing, what I would say about a feasibility study is I've talked to you about a scope of work, talked to you about a size of a building, a cost to renovate the building, or a cost to do a new building, is when you are ready, is you need to determine your financial capabilities and also your opportunities on how to do a project. You know, we may show you today that you need to do a $5 million building project, but you may only have $4 million, okay? So then you gotta scale and look at it a little bit differently. We know what our needs are, but we need to determine what our capability is and also how can we do that. And that's all part of a feasibility study, is determining, well, as I talked about, what the needs are. You need to determine what your financial capabilities are, your opportunities, how can we pay for this, and then you start to look at how you implement it. One thing that this is also something just to keep in back of your mind. It's not something that the fiscal court sets up here and they go, okay, it's good, let's go. Because it takes a lot of time. But with that, it doesn't happen overnight either. Because there is design phases and approvals, not just by these folks, but also by the city, by Jackson, as well as at the state level. So there is a process that we have to go through for design phases and approvals. That can easily take 5 to 6 months, okay? Then you go through a bidding procurement, and you get those permits. And with that is you solicit bids from contractors, and then you get your bids back, then you award. That takes a couple months. Then we gotta go build the building. And it's not one that you build in 3, 4, 5, 6 months like a house. This is something that'll take a little over a year to build. So when you start to add those up, even once the fiscal court says yes, the community supports it, you generate the awareness and build the consensus, it's still a 2-year process. Okay, so that's just something I think that's important to note, is understanding how those costs work, but also understanding it's not something that happens just like that. It does take some time. And that 2 years starts when the fiscal court says, we agree with what this scope is. And that's that feasibility study. The feasibility study could take a day, a month, year, or years to get to where this part starts. Okay, so that's a general, a lot more detail that I could go into this, but I know it's been a long meeting, so I wanted to keep it concise with that. But I think that from our recommendation is that, you know, you do have a 60-year-old building here. There are needs in the building. We've shown you some ways and some things that need to be addressed, and also some realistic costs of what those things are. Whether you do it in phases or do it all at one time is something obviously you all need to talk about and think about on that. But then also look at replacing the building with a in-kind type of facility that meets your needs for the next 40, 50, 60 years, multi-generations, is that the cost wouldn't be that much more to get something that would meet all the building codes, meet all the ADA issues, as well as to also give you some growth in the building. So with that, I'll open it up to any questions folks may have.
Is that the only site that we've looked at?
That was a site that was one that we looked at. Obviously, there could be a whole lot of sites, but that was just one. Yeah, it's right there with the,
yeah,
right where it says no outlet. Right there.
In the parking lot.
In the parking lot, yes. Yeah, the parking lot, I mean, it's basically, it's this area here. That was just one option. Obviously, you probably would, unless this is just something everybody goes 100%, I mean, you would look at probably multiple options. I think one of the challenges that we were asked to look at is potentially something here in the downtown area, keep it close and all the things that go along with those lines.
My main question would be, where are we going to pay for it?
Sir, what was your name again?
My name is Eric, E-R-I-C, Ratz, R-A-T-T-S. I'm principal architect of DLC.
So when we move up to that site, then we can possibly make an apartment structure?
Yes.
With this whole building?
Yes.
In that?
Yes, sir.
As you can tell, Jeff needs some parking.
Yes, it does. Okay, I appreciate all your time, thank you.
Mayor.
I will keep this brief, because I'm about to get my stomach's growling. So the city of Jackson is working on a project to develop a new police station. This is something that was started years ago, that had looked at the building that is at 337 Broadway, right adjacent to our city hall parking lot. And at that time, because of asbestos and the abatement costs and different things, they were not able to follow through with that project. However, the need is still there, and as we got bids to tear down that building in order to prepare a site for a new police station, we realized that the building that's adjacent to that, that the county owns, is in much worse shape than we thought. So I just brought a few pictures to show you guys. This is from the back of the building. This is the front, and you can see how they've actually started leaning, but if you look at the back, they actually are about 4 or 5 feet apart back here, but if you look up here, about they are actually touching each other. I'm just going to leave these here and let them pass them down. But anyway, so in order to tear down the building that we have, we can do that, and we have quotes to do that, and we are going to do that. But what would be most beneficial and a better use of money is if we could just go ahead and acquire the smaller building from the county and tear them both down at once. It would not only help you get rid of an eyesore and a very dangerous, if you looked at it, one of the interior, the ceiling, you could see how bad a shape it is, and you can tell by those pictures that it's not saveable. I love historic buildings. I own a historic building. I would love to be able to save both of those to save some of our structures downtown, but they are not saveable. So what I would like to request today is that the county consider giving that building to the city as a way to help improve our county, our city, our downtown area. It will help give a much needed facelift. We need some structures pulled out to the front of Broadway if we start tearing all that down. So that's what I'm here today to request from the court. If you would consider giving that piece of property, I spoke with the treasurer and I think you all have it valued on insurance about $5,200. And to my knowledge, nobody knows that you're receiving any income from the building. It's just sitting there and falling into disrepair for years. So that would be my request. I'm open to questions, to obviously bringing your all's input into our project with the police department, and just answer any questions you might have.
Well, one thing I want to initiate in is parking lot, where the parking lot is that lot, did you check that, Brandon, is that lot the one of the county?
It is the city's.
I did check it.
As soon as you told me that, I have the deeds on my desk. I should rob. But
well, and that's been when I went to Fort River years ago. I know they wanted to trade, talking about trading the parking lot to the lot where they built the fire station, and they could have done something.
You didn't own the lot where they built the police out of the fire station. But
no, but
my understanding, just by speaking to our clerk, was that years ago, whenever the county worked on the project to build the Justice Center, that the city gave up Court Street and traded that property down on Broadway. So we have many buildings that need worked on. We have lots of room for improvement in our city and our county. And I'm certainly willing to work with you all to do anything I can to build our community up, not tear us down. And I think that as you're looking at this project that these guys talked about, you know, the city owns some property downtown. I'd love to work with you all and look at possible sites or anything the city has. We need to work together. I mean, so I'm open to discussions on any of that property as well.
And too, with that comment, you know, I made a lady come, I don't know if she was in here, come up from Franklin, named Wendy, about a driver license.
I did hear that, and I talked to her as well.
Maybe y'all got a building like, something we can work, you know. But we do need to work together, and I do want to work together to try to improve our image. And, you know, if you've got somewhere over like that, we may be able to work and trade or, you know, something like.
I'm open to discussion. I would like some motion on this as soon as possible, because I need to move forward with demolition of that other building. And while there is a climate of funding at the federal level to pursue this funding, I would like to pursue the funding, or if you drag your feet, you lose it. So.
We should probably use all your funding to go ahead and tear it down.
Exactly.
Well, here's the thing. We don't have that funding available, and we can't apply for that until we get a site. And we have our funds we have saved to prepare that site. So. Well, we had estimates. I can tell you we did not accept any of the quotes, because once we started inspecting and going around the building, we didn't realize how bad the other building was. And like I said, we can go ahead and tear it down. The quotes are between $20,000 and $30,000. That's just for the one building. I would guess your building is going to be expensive to tear down. I mean, it's really not worth what it's going to cost to tear it down, but that's up to you all.
Laura.
Yes.
Can I speak for a second? Yeah. So what you're asking is the county to give the city that lot.
I'm asking the city
to make a motion to give the city.
I would like for them to, and if they're not comfortable today, at least make some type of motion that I can proceed with tearing the other one down. It would be cheaper to do them both together, but I don't think it would cause any injury to your building, because it's already so far gone. But I just think it's in everybody's best interest in the community if we improve our downtown area. Okay, and that building is set vacant for years, and it's, you know, it's going to only get to be more of an eyesore. And if we build a nice building there beside it, it's going to be good, but then it's going to make that one look even worse. So.
Now, for clarification, legal wise, we can give property to another governmental entity as the city. We've done that in the past. So, otherwise, if it's to a project, you have to go through the sale process.
Okay, you want to make a motion? A motion to give a price on Gary Banner?
The building you got now, before we get a few days, just to see what we can work out another location for you, instead of just, you know, giving the county property.
What do you mean another location for you? We're going to build a police station.
No, I'm not.
On Broadway.
Jeff mentioned let's trade something out.
And there's places that the city owns that I think whenever you talk about, I mean, this is the taxpayers' dollars we're talking about. And it's serious. You're talking about a $5 to $6 million commitment. And I think you always need to vet all your possibilities. And so that definitely is a possibility, because the county owns that property. The city also owns property behind us on College Avenue. We own other property on Broadway. I'm just saying we all should work together to consider all the possibilities on how we can improve our community.
And we need a new courthouse, which that's obvious. Maybe we can, like you said, maybe we can sit down and work something out, because, you know, to benefit both parties.
I'm ready and willing to meet, as long as it's not a 3-hour meeting. I have one at 1 o'clock. I've got to go, so.
Good morning.
All
we'll talk to him and come up, and we'll, I think we might have to have something anyway on this, admin building. We'll try to sit down and see what, I'll get with you and see what you've got, maybe that.
All right, the sooner the better, so we can proceed, because this kind of stuff really holds up the progress in your community when you don't make decisions promptly, when you have opportunities to get fundings and such, so thank you for the, being able to address the court today and consider our request.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, next thing on the floor, I'm gonna get back with you. Next one is,
Yeah, you ain't seen him up there, good.
Like to be recognized by the court, please.
Yeah.
I've got a question. While we're all here and our state people are here, we've got solid waste training coming up in the middle of September. You previously stated that no training unless it's mandatory. It's not mandatory training, but it's pretty daggone important. Just asking if I can go while we're all here and on the same page. It's time to go ahead and reserve our rooms for it, so, you know.
Yeah, I need to sit down with you. I got some issues and things that we need to go over anyway. And I just got a paper, just a matter of fact, this morning, I think it was on solid waste coordinator and stuff, and.
Great, you can talk to my attorney about any issues you have with me, sir. I said you can talk to my attorney about any issues you have with me, sir.
I ain't working with attorney, but I mean,
Well, I'll be happy to provide his information. I'm just asking a question, Judge. Yes or no, I mean, it's simple.
No, we might know,
Okay, thank you, Your Honor.
I just wanna add, fiscal court, local officials, magistrates, county judges, perfectly welcome to come to these trainings, and in that folder we gave you, we've got one coming up February 11th, too. It's a good one. It's an orientation type training.
Okay, and I can probably get back with you.
Okay.
If you ladies too. Okay, next thing on the agenda is, 26th meeting, I guess, the meeting y'all had the 21st, I can't remember that. And the reason I said I wanted to address it separate, and we had to anyway since we had it on, and I kind of went over the meeting probably out of order, but again, you all told me to go ahead and have your meeting, and this is what you want to approve the minutes for. It was a meeting that you all had on the 21st at 10 o'clock. Again, I never refused the meeting. Y'all never contacted me in any way. You sent a county deputy out to my house, I was here Friday, and then I worked on the Saturday, and then I left at,
Statute says you're unwilling and unable, Judge.
6 o'clock, huh?
Statute says if you're unwilling and unable, majority of this court can call immediately.
You never get a hold of it if you don't call me on the phone or text me.
You don't call me either.
That's what you said, but, why don't you tell Roy Darrell, tell me, I didn't even know if y'all.
What are you? What you tell him, Roy Darrell? She knew though. Did you or did you not?
The man told me if he a magistrate or a judge.
Did he? What did he tell you?
If he a magistrate or a judge.
Did he pay or not?
He told me, but is he a magistrate or a judge? He can't call me.
He told me that we didn't have to call him.
Anyway, I'm not even gonna address it because it will leave me. You can go through the process to get a hold of me. You can go far enough to get the county attorney to call me and ask if we have a meeting, and we agreed to it.
You're gonna jeopardize $300,000 to coach everyone.
Not sure goodness y'all ain't gonna have a meeting that you all want to.
No, that's on you.
Brandon, do you think the meeting will be at 10 o'clock?
If you guys ask me that question, I'll evaluate the evidence, put it right.
Okay. I want you to check on that, so. We're not gonna make a motion to.
We're talking about taxpayers' money, Judge. Go ahead and do whatever.
The question is, what are you guys gonna do about this money?
Right.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right. That's the bottom line. All this business and back and forth is one thing. What are y'all gonna do about the money?
Going all the way back to A and.
Second reading has to be done.
He went far enough to read it.
Stop screwing everything up.
Chris went far enough to read it. Y'all refused. Y'all did vote on it, but you voted not to accept the first reading. Just a little bit.
We've already had this first reading. That's what you're objecting to.
The meeting wasn't legal.
You're objecting to the $284,000.
You went far enough to have the county attorney call me and ask me when we scheduled a meeting. I got my secretary to come in. I'll repeat again. Come in, and y'all was clicking on about it.
Call
and they refused to come at 3 o'clock.
Judge, I'll clarify. I I was working at my office. I don't have any idea why Mitch and I were talking, other than I've got several water issues and stuff I had to call him about. And he asked me about the meeting and or about what was happening. I told him I would call you, and that's what I did.
So I never asked you to call Jeff Nuttall, did I?
No, I did it on my own position to try to make sure everything would be done correctly.
Your office was notified within ample time according to statute.
You gave me a notice that you were trying to serve upon him.
I gave you a.
To ask him to call a meeting.
Well, secretary received a notice.
Well, okay, that's fine. I mean, I don't have to receive nothing, right? And the judge is the one that has to receive it and has to be able to give him time to call a meeting.
Statute said if he's unwilling or unable. Evidently, he was unable, according to statute. You're the attorney, not me.
Okay, let's go on.
Judge, I have a question.
This meeting, I mean, this, these minutes?
Well, my question is, did you know there was a meeting that morning? I just want to know, did you know?
No.
You did not know at all?
No, didn't have a clue. Came in here, they showed up and.
But you weren't here when they were.
No, I wasn't here. I had a meeting at 10:00.
But you did not know they had called a meeting at all?
Didn't have a clue.
Well, you need to tell the treasurer, what to tell the three quarters of them, they're not paying on time.
We own $284,000?
Oh, you. He didn't tell you what to tell three folks when you cannot pay the bill.
That's Jeff's problem.
Okay, next thing, Kate.
I got a question, Judge.
Yes, sir.
On the special meeting that morning, is the county attorney supposed to attend? Did I get legal?
He wasn't even here. He wasn't notified.
He says you're supposed to be here.
Did you attend the special meeting that morning?
No.
Didn't know anything about it.
And I put you on the spot, but.
I think.
Because I didn't know.
Here's the situation, okay? And I feel foolish about this, but I don't check my texts a whole lot. And to be honest with you, Magistrate Bush had sent me a notice of a meeting that morning, or on Monday. I did not look at it. Honestly, I was sitting up there working at 10:00. And the next day, they came to, these guys came to district court and asked me about that, and I wholeheartedly, I'm not gonna tell them the truth about it, as I told them about it. Wouldn't realize that I actually called a meeting, and that's the bottom line. That's what I stated when I came over at 3:00. But they had sent me a notice, he had sent me a text. I fully admit that. I didn't look at it until a day or two later. I've got 10 on here right now, I haven't looked at it.
So really cool.
Steve, that's your question. Here's a signed amendment, budget amendment from Robert Brown, from the state local finance officer, stating that everything's okay. So obviously, it's okay with Robert Brown, but it's not okay with Mr. Nuttall.
But does Robert Brown know that the county attorney didn't call?
And to be quite honest with you,
when I called Robert Brown said.
I called the judge and group at 12:32 on Monday afternoon. I would have told him. And actually, on Friday, you guys were trying to call a meeting, and you said you were going to have the sheriff serve it. And
because we couldn't get contact.
And I told.
We're there Friday.
And I told.
I'm right here.
The treasurer, I would actually try to call a judge on Saturday to make sure they do. And I never did. So,
Judge,
all
for the good of the county, then, how can this be worked? That day is over with, the 10:00?
Absolutely. I don't know how many times I have to say. I talked to Robert Brown, and Robert Brown said the judge had to sign it.
That day's gone.
Yeah,
what can we do right now? Everybody suck it up.
You're saying Robert Brown forged his name on the bottom? What are you saying?
What they're saying is Robert Brown might not.
Second reading and approve the money. That's all I need to do.
Judge.
Make a motion. A second reading. That's all I need to do. He's on this authority kick, that's the deal, but all he's got to do is consider a motion for a second reading of this budget, man. It's a done deal.
That's a lot of money.
Who cares who signed?
That's right, I don't.
But if he disagrees, if he thinks he should.
If it is, let Jeff sign it. Well, now another thing, sign it.
Robert Brown, oh, we have to sign it, I mean.
Would you sign it then?
Well, that, ain't that what I just done on item I?
It's the first reading, Jim. We done had the first reading, read the first reading, we'll approve the second reading, you'll get the money.
Let me call Robert Brown, who talked to Robert Brown and said that that was legal, you did, Donnie?
No, I talked to him months ago.
Okay, you said.
Over months ago, I didn't talk to him months ago.
We're talking about $300,000, Judge Singer, that's it.
Hey, legal lady.
Everybody just listen.
Hello and welcome. Please enter the number of the person you are calling. Or to spell the name, press 1. To access your phone. Using your keypad, please spell the name on the first.
Hold on, man, who has to be present at that, call that meeting? Who has to be there?
Excuse me?
Who has to be there at these meetings? The manager calls the meetings.
There has to be a court.
Who has to be there?
Court.
I have three men.
Is that true? So three, yeah, that's it, that's all it has to be.
And then there's three of them walking around the streets of Jackson. That should be an open meeting.
So that was at both of those meetings. Was that the morning, and the evening?
What do you have to do, sign the ordinance? You got to do an $84,000.
No, nobody's signed, I just want to know who has to be at the meeting, because what she's saying is, I don't know what she's asking, but who has to be? And what we're questioning now is if that Robert Brown signed that paper or not, is that what we're asking you? This is our law, there's like.
He said it wasn't legal for a magistrate, they took the original paperwork, got the county judge executive and all of it, and put county judge or acting chairman.
Is that the problem, Judge? Is that the whole problem?
It is.
Sign it.
Who gave you that?
Here's another, make it the same.
Hey, Robert, this is Jim from the Russ County Judge Executive. I talked to you last week about this, this week about this budget amendment 2020 BA-001. When I was on the phone with you, I was telling you that they offered it to paper, they had a meeting, and where it says County Judge Executive, they actually put acting chairman at the end of it, and Donnie Bush, the manager, had signed it. You told me, and I thought the only way a budget would be any good if the county judge executive signed it. So if you don't care to give me a call back and let me know, I would appreciate it. That's why I wrote in my note, but they were saying they talked to you and said the manager could sign it, so that's the issue. They're going to make sure it's legal, and we don't lose that on this $284,935 budget amendment. Or go turn the problem. My number is 6-5-6-8-7-9-2-4. Thank you. What I would recommend you to do, if Robert Brown says it's okay to sign this, I don't care a bit to do that, but I'd like to go ahead and make a motion to go ahead and make Chris read that again, do a first reading on it, make me sign it, send it in, that way we'll have it, and he can send it back to me that day. You all done that meeting on that day?
Why don't you just make it?
What's the deadline, Donnie?
Today, it's advertised, today it has, the second reading has to be signed, it's through the whole process.
Okay.
Always got it.
Okay, listen.
Change the motion to second reading.
I'm not going to say it again. I talked to Robert, and Robert said the only way a budget amendment can get the judge signed it. Leave it at that. Y'all don't want to make a motion, forgiveness, go on.
I'll make a motion to consider the second reading of this budget amendment, so we won't lose the money, so you can sign and do whatever you have to do.
I said.
I'm not, I'm not, I'm not, I'm not.
But,
I'm not gonna do that, go through these, I'm not gonna do that, go through these, you know, let these meetings again, go back over and forth,
Is that legal for them to do that?
Got a motion and a second?
I got a motion to accept the second reading.
Why don't you take one vote to pass the first reading retroactive to Monday when you have the meeting? Take your second vote, they pass it, let the judge sign it, see if that flies. That may save the whole city.
That okay to you? So you can sign it.
That's what I had to say. Long we get.
Get done.
You can get down, Chris, retroactive, like, at least you have.
You guys approved this, they're different factions.
Do we have a motion for this? I'll second the motion.
Approve the first.
Donnie Bush.
First reading, correct?
Yeah, first reading retroactive, that's what we're gonna do, sign it, send it in.
Aye.
Roy Darrell.
Aye.
Ray Moore.
Aye.
Al Changer.
Aye.
Motion carried.
Let's do the second reading.
So he's gonna sign the one that Robert Brown has signed, right?
Do we have to have a second?
Second reading today. Make a motion for a second reading?
And, you know, it technically says it's supposed to be on two separate days, but you got to do the second one.
Top $300,000.
Let's go ahead and do the second reading on, you got it, Chris, have you got a copy of it?
Same thing.
Just change the first to the second reading, make a motion.
Ready to begin, Chris.
Hey. Second reading is an ordinance reading relating to the fiscal year 1920 annual budget and amendment thereof, where the Brezzi County Fiscal Court has realized unbudgeted receipt for quality funds given down by the Brezzi County Fiscal Court of the Commonwealth of Kentucky. And it is for the amount of $2,004,935. Have a motion.
Motion.
Second.
Roy Darrell.
Aye.
Ray Moore.
Aye.
Al Changer.
Aye.
Donnie Bush.
Aye.
Motion carried. Okay.
Just for my minutes, the item was on was to approve January 21st meeting, and then that got turned into this.
No, we just went ahead and done the budget amendment on, that was on that thing.
Which was it? Which agenda item was that?
I'm sorry.
Well, and I don't want to get into this, but you guys, you know, on that sheriff's budget, you didn't take any action back on it. Oh, you probably have to act, take a motion to table that, because you do have to take some action on it to table. We'll get to that in the next one.
Let's just go ahead and do that over there, if you don't, we'll make up.
I'll try to check them off.
Motion to go ahead and table all consideration from the Brezzi County Sheriff, 2020 P account, until we change review. Have a second. Ray Moore.
Aye.
Al Changer.
Aye.
Donnie Bush.
Aye.
Roy Darrell.
Aye.
All right.
Brad, can we? And this, in the January 21st meeting, we adopted the budget, you know, but we also made a motion and approved, authorizing you to pursue, stipulate an appeal in regard to case number 2019 CI-0274. Will that be addressed later, or?
I think so, I need to talk with you about that during the session.
Okay.
Definitely, going back to your resolution, I'd like to make a motion, we go ahead and put $2,000 in each district.
Per month.
Per month.
Per month. Right.
I ain't got no clue about drain pipe.
But whatever we need to name, what we have, I don't remember the figure we have, drain pipe, was it month?
As long as we do, according to how we passed, majority of the court, a 50-50 deal with some states, Jack's like.
Some limit on that per month.
No, I'm not.
I think it was 70 in the budget, and y'all, you got dollars, $2 in the budget.
Be 62-50, which would be 15-62-50.
And right now, we got a 6-foot pipe, 2 6-foot pipes over here, you can't hardly go down. We
We got about, I got about 15 times to do chain right now.
But before we do that, are we going to, which list are we going to buy? Are we going to let you facilitate everything, or are we going, are we turning our roads, or what?
We just do it like it's always been, y'all.
That's always been, that's always, what's always been, has been the problem.
Well, I can get with Bridget there, I can show you most if y'all turn one road.
If I turn in Bridget.
If I turn every road you got into Bridget, and she'll put it on the list,
Okay, that's what she does, put it on the list, but that's hard to go.
Well, dang, we got that bid pretty much taken care of.
Oh, we have.
Really, I mean, I've got stuff on there, it's been on there all the time.
I have too.
Roads have been gravel since that's been turned.
I've got Hampton Church down there, been on there, and I've told Bridget I don't have any now.
Now, back up here, y'all gave me a list here about a month ago, and y'all realize, we ain't bought no gravel in 7 months, I got a great big list that's in front of your office. They call every day in my office here and turn a road in to do gravel. And just like I said on Ray, while ago, he turned 9 or 10 roads, and 5 of them was already on my list.
Yeah, I was allocated on the 26th, Judge, this is almost February. You still pouring over $2,000 gravel, like you ain't had the ability to do nothing. Well, if you got the gravel on the ground, then, if you deliver it.
We got one over on the truck, I think everything else has been delivered. But again, $2,000, let's go ahead and put this in a motion. To go ahead and put, spend $2,000 in each district.
On the roads that we need, or?
All of them, yeah, I mean, I.
On the roads we need.
Yeah, I mean, every one of them together. And I think you're all, I think, so every one of y'all, some of these roads you turned in has already been fixed. What road they been turned in there?
You got two roads I got to fix.
Two? How many you turned in?
You had two of them.
Wait, how many you turned in?
About 8 or 9.
8 or 9, right. Got two of them, or got a fourth of them done, was already on my list. Motion for $2,000 in each district.
I'm so glad you done gravel, you did mine.
And that's beside the FEMA project, we know that.
Right, but I like for it to be where the roads that we want to fix, the roads we recommend.
All y'all got to do is share them in, Bridget give them, we got a gravel list, and I think the list that they got turned in.
I've got them all right here.
Everything that's been turned in, is it on the list that they came in to?
List of what?
You got them on the list, I mean, they came in, right?
Yes, the one I just got the list passed out.
And I don't think they've not been worked on any different than, again, I've got roads that have been. I got roads that's been turned in for 6 months, and they will not be for retail ready right now.
These go back to February of last year, some of them that has not been done.
Okay, let's see, I'd like to see that, that's what I've got here.
That's what you've got too.
Are we going to work on bus turn and cemeteries?
Well, that's something else I need to sit down and talk to you about, on the cemetery, I haven't put no gravel, because I haven't bought no gravel, but I had a few turned in, I just went for a quick pre-gravel on some, and got away with great, but today, it was, they had mud, and I couldn't do nothing for it. Knox County, they got a form filled out, and I've got one in my office too. Somebody's going to be buried and need gravel, I've got a form, I'm getting on the sign, I'm giving us permission to work on it.
How about the bus turns?
Bus turnaround, here's what I think we need to do with bus turnaround, I got a great big list of roads and turnaround. I think at some point, we need to sit down with the Board of Education and these bus turnarounds, see if they'll buy the gravel, we'll haul it right down, I don't think we can afford to buy the gravel.
Well, we're getting to that year past, Judge.
Well, Anthony Mullin, but I mean, I think we need to sit down and have a meeting and say, hey, if y'all can buy the gravel, we can do this. Because I was talking to Bridget just this week, low bus turnaround is not in the county road plan.
So if I have a little one pass away, I need gravel on cemetery, you can't help it.
Oh, I don't think we could not put him. Why would you even ask me something like that?
Well, they've been some that said that you have it.
Well, you bring them in here, and I'll tell you that they're lying.
I don't want to mention nobody's name, you know? They don't deserve it.
I want that list though, and their name, because I don't believe that. Because they call all the time, but Mill Creek Road, well, I'm going to the gravel. Boomer Lane, see that's on here to gravel, but we can't gravel that, that's not in the road plan. And the next one needs gravel, Potter Hill Loop, I talked to that lady this week, and I told her I would get her gravel this week, I don't know who did it.
It's been on the list, I know, a year.
But, June the 10th, you ain't got no gravel since June until this last month.
book, and I'm not that here to go through all these things, but I would need to do it, get a list, I need to get a credit, we need to get,
What we do on the pack?
I can take one at max myself, and I can haul 2,000 gravel myself. There's no excuse for that.
What we agree on the pack?
I think we need to.
We're ready to take 2,000.
Sell boats by 2 days, day and night.
Why don't we do that in order, Ellis?
I've done it before, Ellis.
Do what?
What about the, that order that you all have already approved, why don't we go in order by that?
That's right.
If you get, you just come get with me, and I'll give you my whole list, we just go down to whatever.
Remember, we put them on the list, and I called, that's when I had to call, and they got, gave me approval, we still got that list, and we've not done yet. I still got it.
I go over my roads, my name, the police, my board, my permit, no.
That's a sweet thing.
Spend 2,000 on your deal, for being gravel. If needed, in the easiest route. Been 2 or 3 days, I'm still,
But still get that whole question.
What do you want, Brady?
You want to clarify something?
Yeah, I think Donnie had a bid price on Bedlin, and, Kirby had, but some, if somebody had got time, we need to go ahead and, give it to whoever got it, if we need it, or order them if.
I pulled the minutes on that, Judge, and they had voted 50-50, just like the courts house, according to the minutes, whenever we took the, but the bid, that we could get 50 from Herbie and 50 from Southern States, just like we do the parts house.
Right. We did, let's do get it from both of them.
And we had it, haven't we?
No, you told me to get plastic only from Jackson Electric.
How many times have we bought since then? Zero. You came in after when I came in with your.
Well, I just want to clarify that before we go further.
Well, we haven't bought more times since then. But that was my understanding, that Herbie was the best price on plastic, how much right at you, was it not?
That's not how they voted, they voted 50-50 like the parts house. Chris, did you pull the minutes?
I ain't got any problem, I'd be tickled to death about both of them.
They might be a.
Let's go ahead and make a motion.
$4 or $5 difference in the price.
Make consideration of motion to put $2,000 in gravel on each district, not counting the FEMA projects, and pipe in each district if needed.
On the roads that we.
Yeah, whatever road you've been turned in. And I have got a pipe that was turned in on, Josh's lane, I went up there and looked at.
I already got to take care of it.
Yeah, I went up there and they put a pipe in, I don't know where to go, they put one in my quarters.
I gave it to them, it was a great one, it all looked as good as anything. At least they got a pipe.
Anybody want to make a motion, but you have our new district pipe.
Let's transfer the money. Let's address the interest of Hampton Church off the place for problem. Did you not tell me to get me a shovel piece? That you were possible, actual piece.
I didn't tell you that, but I told Brittany, I said, it's a shame we got a master, got a hole up there, I'm gonna take a shovel and fill a hole in him.
I'll be our Bob.
A shovel, Donnie.
Again, y'all have voted on my gravel, but they had my gravel on top of it.
And I just want to say this again, I know I've said it many a time during my time as previous as county attorney a couple of times so far. I would love for you guys, I know it'd be a big process, but I'd gladly give up a week if y'all would just go back and take every road in the county and have a public hearing on it and decide what's a county road and what's not for the length of it, and that way you can clarify all these issues.
Telling you,
that's a big undertaking, but man,
we got more roads that's been worked on in the past to adopt it in the
problem road. Is we can't get fixed what's already done.
You guys keep asking me legal issues about it, and that's what it takes to solve the legal issues.
Right.
And we got workers, and if it's 345 and they on 380, they'll call the sheriff's department, they'll not go on private property, and that's true. It's always been done.
Well, are you not?
We got a. But our consideration motion for $2,000 for gravel on each district and how it's needed. And do we need to go ahead and add in there to do a budget transfer?
Per month.
Yeah, that was me.
Yeah.
To the next meeting.
Yes. Pipe and gravel.
Regular meeting.
1 month.
Per month, yeah.
Let's get that.
That wasn't that way before. Y'all spent $2,000 on each district. But Okay, do we have a motion? Do we have a second? Ray Moore.
Aye.
Bill Tinker. Donnie Bush.
Aye.
Roy Darrell.
Aye.
We've got in here KBS, can you tell me, I'll look down there. Discussion and consideration and approval KBS for $20,000 for.
K beans, V E.
$10,000.
E M S.
And ten?
Ten. I missed it, one, ten.
Twenty, Nick, for, any for, for Breath County, Will County Animal Service for Board of Zim, is that one of my motions is, and what you said, Donnie?
Right.
Biggie motion.
Right.
It's, K beans, award $10,000 for Breath, Will Animal Service, that's annual.
Who you gonna give it to?
Breath Wood.
Breath Wood.
What's it for?
It's like.
Every year, the state awards, $10,000 in allotment for animal services. I don't know if it's contained in certain things, Steve can probably do, he's the one who got one last year. What does that include you can do with that, Steve?
They got certain equipment supplies you can buy through, for your animal service.
So, why not divide it between the two animals?
You can't do that, it has to be done to one.
You gotta rotate it every year.
Well, they got it last year, should want taking it this year.
McIntosh got it last year. But when.
Nobody got anything last year.
Breath bought it, it was too far down to the year for McIntosh to be able to transfer it back over, and we had to send it back to the state.
We sent last year's back, nobody.
Nobody got it last year. And I talked to him, not nobody here, no. I talked to him.
Next year, we'll get it?
What we've done.
I take that to the bank.
What we've done in the past.
That's why we're doing it?
Yeah, we want to coordinate, however we get it one year, and then McIntosh to next, then just keep switching.
So this year, it'll be Breath and Wolf, and next year, it'll be White's Cat.
Yeah.
In January.
It's really awarded till July.
Till July.
But you have to send in. January 31st.
Send in notice to whom?
They just signed, and I did talk to Tim about it last week, he had called me, but I don't know if he never wrote anything in here for me to sign, so.
Well, I'm here representing White's Cat, so, as their office manager.
It'll come to you guys next year.
Okay, I just need to know what documents fill out, so that.
Tim will worry, but me and him talked just last week about it, and I've actually think it wasn't due till April, and it don't get awarded until July.
Okay, alright.
Hey, Donnie Bush, did we vote on that? We already did, didn't see it. Roy Darrell, no?
No, we didn't vote on it.
I got too much stretch here, hold on, let me find that where it is. Okay, need a motion to, I had Donnie to read it, but then who?
Second.
Roy Darrell. Ray Moore. Bill Tinker. Donnie Bush.
Aye.
Let's see, executive session, but I've got two people, let's let, already have one name written down here, if we do know the people, Ashley Barney. Anybody go first, Ashley?
Well, Becky was gonna do it, speeches and things about the clerk's office. In 2019, we processed over $2.2 million in revenue in our office. Today, we turned over to the fiscal court $151,000 in payments. Another thing we had done this year, we increased our usage revenue by over $60,000. And Becky reached out to all the dealerships in Perry County, and asked them, you know, if someone from Breath County bought their car at their dealership, would they hold back that transfer and let us come pick it up? So our county receives those fees and taxes, so she goes once a week up there and picks up a transfer. So that's a result of that. And we were, you know, under budget in 2019, but as in regards to our budget, I kind of thought we had that worked out, y'all. questions or anything, I'll, you know, I'll just, I wish you'd come to us and let us go over it again. But this year, revenue for our recordings is went like significantly, deeds, everything, mortgages, and legislation actually went through, and there's a $10 fee attached to every recording. That $10 fee is, it's called a document storage fee. We're gonna make probably $30,000 on that fee. That money, due to legislation, is to be used in the clerk's office. It's not clerk revenue, I can turn over the thing to the user. So we took that revenue, we added part of it to equipment, we added the other part to salary line item. So that's where we got those numbers. Even with that, next year, in addition to like the tax payments we give you guys monthly, we're projecting over, you know, $55,000 of our clerk fee money that we will be turned over to fiscal court at the end of the year. So, you know, that's a huge increase for everyone, that's the county, everybody. But that document storage, but you can look that up, that is supposed to stay in. But with the budget, Donnie, did I hear you write you're taking off the training and conventions and travel? I think this year, 2019, we spent $8,000 on going to training. I feel it's, you know, you're doing everybody, you know, an injustice to us, the community, everybody, to not allowing your employees to go to training. That's where we learn, I mean, everybody should get to go.
Tell the judge that.
Yeah.
Well, I'm explaining how to work the hour office.
They're not part of the fiscal court, I can't tell them what to do with the money.
Your Majesty.
Well, I mean, it's zeroed out our budget, but that's where we, you know, we have, state board elections is constantly changing things, updating things. We won't know about that stuff if we don't go to those trainings. We don't know about fee increases or things that has to be done, or legislation passed, or, you know, this board is outdated, they passed this board, you know, we wanna know that stuff, that's why we go.
Well, I think we go.
You all should go too, everybody should go.
Since he's been sworn in, we pay every penny out of our pocket, if we didn't choose to go.
That's beautiful.
Yeah, I am too.
I know, but Donnie, that has nothing to do with the clerk's office.
You didn't take it back up, when I came in here, if it hadn't been a clerk turn of money, and they couldn't make paper on, I don't wanna be in that situation.
That's how.
And I'm not gonna put us in that situation.
The money she's generating, she's talking about, she's generating the clerk's office, that's what the whole county runs off of, that's how we make money. More you make, the more it helps everybody, sheriff department, every department in this county, that's how we operate.
Yeah, that's the monthly fees, but I'm talking about excess clerk fees money, that's money that's not paid out every month to taxing districts. Like right now, we pay, the county gets a check, the sheriff gets a check, the school system, the city school, the health department, those are our taxing districts, we pay them out monthly.
The reason I.
That's separate from.
You know the reasons, why not be in another county? First of all, Mr. Oliver's a clerk down there, his family gave me a job, but I'd have two pennies rubbed together. And I go down there, and he treats me like a human, if I go over there.
Sure, we'll get treated like a human.
I know, I'm treating you not.
So, well, yeah, if I go into a store and somebody treats you like a stranger, I can be here, I'll be back. It's a shame, but that's just the way it is.
We encourage everybody, if you live in Breath County, you know, that's how your schools run, your health department, your library, it's, you know, some of those funds, I mean, it's important, but transfer your car, license it, do all that here. But, you know, I thought we agreed on the budget last week. Obviously not, but it's an unbalanced budget right now, we bring into this last year, your line items do not match.
You got a cap, 205.
Right, but.
The rest of.
DLG says that your line items for those have to equal it, Donnie. If I go by my line item, I'm gonna go way over on max order, or vice versa. That's not a balanced budget.
It's a cap, I just read the figures, it's $109,000 was the first.
You know, and the budget's lacking.
You got a little room to play there, I mean, 201, wherever it is, but your cap is 205, you still under your cap. The projected price of everything, I don't read it out.
Robert Brown told us it needs to be a balanced budget, and it's not. Those figures correspond with each other.
Right.
I know that.
Okay.
Okay, then all you have to do is just take what you got and bounce it out. Simple.
Okay.
But anyway, that's about all we had, we just,
Well, they have balanced budgets, you can see the difference, anybody can have to be done, but,
Well, I mean, that's what, you know, we always, that's why we go to those trainings, we work with Robert Brown. He taught us that last year, that's why we had to come back and amend our budget last year, because it did not match. I don't know if y'all remember, you amended our budget last year.
If you amend it, if you can put a line item on $221,000, why can't you do it until five? You did, you.
You can't, I mean, I'm not saying you can't.
So why don't you do that? You got your count, so pay out and do it.
The maximum order was $221,000, that's what you all agreed to with us. Y'all asked me to go over the numbers with us, we all sitting here for 2 hours. I mean, I just feel like, guys, I mean, Lord, we need to
Well, they ain't balanced.
Work together on this.
You got the same thing you got last year, asking $205,000.
I know, I'm just.
If she wants to give you a raise, I don't know what to tell you, but we can't give you $225,000.
I didn't say that, I'm going over changes in our office. And retirement went up this year, the state says that, we don't, it's going up like 2%, that's part of that maximum order.
You're still on the cap, you're still on the cap, I asked you. You're still on the cap.
Okay, anything else, Ashley?
I think that's all I have, right?
Okay. We just have to look at it, make a balance, you have to send in, they send back, and have to send back over, have to amend it, I mean, have to balance budget and send in.
I mean, you know, they approved the budget, I just.
They don't worry, if you count $1 million, your budget's still gonna be balanced.
We just wanna be part of it, work with them, and just work it out together.
So balance, I said balance, you balance at $211,000, balance at $205,000.
Donnie, I'm saying the line items do not calculate to $205,000, that's what my point is. And you all amended last year's budget, you amended the budget last year because of that.
No.
Okay, thank you, Ashley, that we have to send in, and then that worked out, and then we'll make a move, I guess. And there comes Janie Griffin.
Well, I have sat here for 3.5 hours waiting to talk, and I can tell you this much right here. The little retirement that you fellas get is not worth what you're putting yourself through. Because I know what my dad gets, and he served 3 terms on this fiscal court. But the reason I'm here, I won't be back again, I promise you that, unless something bad happens, I won't come back here. But while I was sitting here, I got on Facebook and I brought up the photograph that I took on August 14th. And it was right over there. It was Donnie Bush, Roy Darrell Harrell, Irene Moore, Ray Moore, and Ellis Dicker. And all four of you fellas voted to recognize Irene Moore. And you put up, signs to go to town line. Let me tell you what all that girl has achieved. You can't name me one athlete in this county who has achieved what Irene did. She was first team All-State in 1978. She was MVP state tournament in 1978. She was Kentucky Miss Basketball in 1978. In 2004, she was inducted into the Morehead State University Hall of Fame. In 2007, she was inducted in the Kentucky High School Athletic Association Hall of Fame. In 2019, I myself went with her to 2 different ceremonies. One was in Lexington when it was announced that she would be in the Kentucky High School Basketball Hall of Fame. And then we went back in July or August, and she was inducted into the Hall of Fame. There were over 500 people there. Her picture was up on a wall and everything. And she walked across the stage and received a ring from the Kentucky Athletic Hall of Fame. I brought up that picture, and it was taken on August the 14th. And all four magistrates voted to honor Irene. The motion passed. Nothing done. On September the 24th, there was another meeting, and one of the magistrates asked about it. Ray Moore made a motion, seconded by Ellis Tencher, to install Irene's road sign, and MOA, KYDOH, Three magistrates voted yes. Ray Moore, Ellis Fisher, Donnie Bush. This time Roy Darrell didn't vote. Motion passed. Now again, on October 11th, it was brought up, and nothing still has been done. There's been nothing sent to the highway office because only two people went to the highway office and asked about the check.
I mean, the meeting was in the back.
Now why hasn't this young woman been on these road signs?
Yeah, did you have to sign it anyway? Or did you stay out of the problem?
So all it has.
Or you had, I don't know. Maybe not.
Is that Bishop Renner?
Did you?
Well.
I did.
You signed?
I think the lady's name. We can't do it anyway, sign it at the county road. The state will not allow people to sign, the only meeting. Ready County has no football, it's got a sign, and it's in. No work to be put up. I told the lady, we can go in front of her house and put a sign up, or we can adopt part of a road. And her rim, and her honor. But we can't put one of these in the county road, it's against state law. So I did go over and sign it, the boy was in here when I told him that, because Ray Moore, he made the comment, we made the bridge at 11:10, but it was already named.
Who'd you talk to, because they say they've not talked to anyone.
The lady that had the MOA, I can't think of her name, there's a town.
Stephanie Bowman's who I talked to.
There, that's who I talked to, Stephanie Bowman, the lady that I talked to.
What'd she say?
You can't do it, it's against all state law.
But there's more signs now than that.
Huh?
There's more signs now than that.
She don't want that one, Tim.
You can't put it, period, it's against state law.
Oh, okay. They're all on.
What do they put up against the law then?
If I ring, we'll pick up, I just told you what she said we could do, Stephanie Bowman. We can put a sign in front of her house, it's home of Ray Moore, or we can go.
That's a slap in the face, anybody that's received it, she was even recognized on the floor of the legislature this year.
She's on the floor.
I ain't gonna be here to put for Ray Moore, I'm waiting to hear after she did, I know what she done. She's probably, she's a remarkable athlete, and I think she's been recognized, and we do need to put a sign, but.
What sign is there now?
Where they wanna do it at.
What sign is there now?
Where the county homeowner, where the county bomb cat or something.
Well, there's lots, there's Marie Roberts, cheerleaders, there's Paul of Sturgeon Simpson, there's.
I'm just saying what you said.
There's several.
Not taking anything from them.
It's not in the way, you can agree with sign.
But this girl has, she has achieved the office of awards, and those people down there at the Kentucky Athletic Association, those older men, I had my camera walk up behind them. Do you know who that is over there? Oh man, yeah, I remember her. She come down that floor like her pants were on.
I remember, I graduated the year after.
There's no comparison.
Somebody needs to go to the highway department and fight for it.
I'm gonna go ask her again, we did not bring it back to the court, but this court right here knows that I told them just exactly what I just said.
Take pictures of each end of the county, you can see.
We don't want a big sign now.
We don't want it.
We can do, out of our hands, we pay.
Did you try to? Can you guys go to the?
We have talked to her, she don't need you.
Well, that's where everybody wants, well, that's a slap in her face, but then in their week.
Thank you, Jamie, I checked into that,
and they said it's illegal, maybe step on what you're talking about, and I'll find out, and.
I hope you all do it, because there's more than one way to skin cat.
Yeah, ain't nobody, I'm by sign, I've got that bit of.
No saying, there's more than one way to skin a cat. You get put off, you're either on the inside of the house or the outside of the roof.
Judge, if I make a compromise here, do we not own a little piece of property there where the moral thing is, or just on the inside of Breath County there on the right, if you're gonna look in a little bit, that little memorial thing that got there.
Right.
Does the county own that?
With the flag and stuff.
Yeah, could we put something there? Could we put something there? If it's county, just a suggestion, you know, you allow it, you say.
If
You're going to.
I think that flags in the second.
So I'll get with Stephanie again and the everything that we talked to. And get it right, and then again, I'm not playing, I told you to see if I ever wanted, but I'll get with myself and see if she wants.
Well, going in for the power, or run a 15, or.
Why don't we go on this county route?
Right.
Why is that the state route? With some of the air, what are we gonna do?
Well, like I say, the state even offered to put one in front of her house, or in the part where she lived at, but I'll get with her and then we go from there, but thank you, Jamie.
Have you sent it up anything over there too, a check or anything?
What now?
Has there been a check sent, a signature or the paperwork anymore?
No. And again, as far as that, I don't even know if they have a charge or something or not, but if they did, I'm sure you paid for it out of pocket. Is that what y'all think, Betty?
I just called Stephanie right then, and she said that it can't be put at the county line. She said, just like Jeff said, because.
I just said that.
Well, I know.
Well, I just wanna tell you what she said.
Oh, okay.
Did you ask why there's so many?
And she said that we couldn't put it on Highway 15, because it's a highway veterans highway. She said anywhere else that she would want it, we could put it, and then all we gotta do is call her with the location. And then you have to do the resolution with the location on it.
So what was Marie Roberts, were those put up before it was a veterans highway?
Yes, those were put up before they decided it was too many.
So, but I mean, that's what I mean, I'm here, and I know you all remember we sit here talking about that, and they offered to put it in front of the house, or.
Brenda has.
Living in.
I mean, I may have a solution for you, I'll let you know what I was saying about that.
Okay, thank you. This time, we'll make a motion, accept the motion to go into executive session on tax issue. Have a motion?
Motion.
I'll say. This time, I'm waiting for everybody to leave. Donnie Bush. Okay, we did executive session talking about a tax issue problem. At this time, we're gonna let the county attorney check into it, and no action be taken right now.
Motion.
Second.